With this, I have to do a lot of reading because the research has become so intense and there is so much copious information that I'm glad that the brother has allowed me the time to give it to you. So with that, I will say this. Beloved brothers and sisters, I believe that we have arrived at a place in our metaphysical odyssey together where our ongoing investigations and critiques of the motives, methodologies, principles, and personalities of good and evil should have yielded for us enough critical points of reference by which to recognize those courses that ultimately leads us to making a better world. For nearly 30 years, I have dedicated the intellectual capacities of my personal mind to deciphering and code-breaking the often intricate and perplexing events that are instigated by those privileged few so-called elite men and women who practice those modes and methods of behavior and that ultimately result in consequences that we, the people, experience as evil. In fact, giving praise and thanks to you, those of you who continue to come and visit with me all these years, for helping to inspire me, much of whom and what I have become today has been primarily based on my somewhat overzealous search for the nucleus of reality in all things, the nucleus of which the central life core sustaining the elusive thing that we want to find, that thing that we call truth. I want to thank you for all of the times we gave the call out, sent up the flare, coerced, asked you to come in the cold, to sit in the cold. I want to give thanks to your spirit for motivating your body to do that. I said all this as my introduction to this particular gathering because I wish for you to also consider it a type of epilogue to a well-traveled and what I believe to be overworked theme of topics, that being our ongoing analysis, reporting, and essentially reacting to the instigators and perpetrators of evil. At this point, I wish to say a few words to those beautifully genuine brothers and sisters who have contacted me virtually from all points around the country. I have noticed that a good many of you have given me an undeserved title, an undeserved honor of being some sort of a prophet, sage. Please let me say here and now that although I consider this to be highly flattering sentiments, it is still just that, a sentiment. A sentiment that I believe is based on a genuinely honest, although misguided, perception of who I am. Yes, what I do in my work, especially in the health field, may appear at times as prophecy, but we all have this very special ability. This ability develops in accordance with each individual, and it is strengthened over time by the seeker's own focus, dedication, and implementation of will, insight, and action. In other words, when it comes to the principle, the dynamic, the so-called gift of prophecy, there is no great secret. Prophecy is as with all things, and it's simple. Dedication rewards the dedicated. Dedication rewards those dedicated. Robert Ghostwolf said something interesting on the subject of prophecy, and he said, prophecy is a vision of what is or could be, not what is written in stone, and he is correct. For all of the publicity given to this subject, prophecy is not based on facts because, as Krishnamurti has taught me, facts are all of the past. What we believe will be is based upon a foundation of accumulated facts. It is codified memories based on a crystallization of conjecture from past events. Prophecy to me, therefore, is simply one's ability to enter what I call zero-point immediacy. Zero-point immediacy is a place where, from its center outward, all action ceases. It does not mean that there is no activity. It is called inactivity. Let me say that again. Inactivity. It is where all things exist in potential, where no thing yet exists materially. And by the observation of nature mother, of human behavior, of both as seasonal trends, of the cyclic rhythms of our solar system and the universe, one inevitably acquires the ability to decipher and ultimately prophesize and read from within that immediacy, the uncertain scripts that you call tomorrow. It's like that CBS show about a dude who gets the delivery of the morning paper from a cat, I might add, that tells him what will happen the next day. Again, I am saying all this in the hope that the times you and I have shared have mutually helped us to progress beyond the need to grind our wheels with superficial distractions, preoccupying our precious attention with the mischief of desperate men. In fact, the most predictable men and events are those professing to represent the purity of Christ himself, and are in reality the incubators of evil, which should leave no doubt in your mind just who this Christ really was. Now, please don't get me wrong. I am not advocating that you don't pay attention to what is going on in the game from time to time. But just think about the amount of precious time and precious intellectual light of attention that we all sacrifice and exhaust to process the bullshit we do into our bloodstreams every day. This is why this type of awakening we are presently experiencing as a species could only begin with a select few, you. This is why there are so few of us that come consistently when the call goes out. So few of you carry that little indistinguishable light that leaders, innovators, and pioneers, visionaries possess. The little light that keeps you focused on the real, as Morpheus said in The Matrix. And as I said in the previous meeting, the particulates of conscious light that has fueled this evolutionary mandate of our planet are all but totally consumed, polluted, or dissipated by man's preoccupation with pseudo-intellectual bullshit, which is all given the appearance of legitimacy by the aristocracy of evil. The way we have been both taught to utilize this precious light of perception causes us to dissipate it. Our focus of attention has been regulated towards primarily ego-based activities. Activities which stimulate and occupy the moment, like white sugar, which eventually robs one of their reservoirs of individual light-based intelligence. People like these become totally immersed in the illusions of somatic consciousness, controlled through their appetite entities, which were cultivated and nurtured by that aristocracy of evil. But those who seek to serve the higher good, those who utilize the light codes to establish and embellish universal synergistic harmony, those who accumulate and accrue the light, storing it as unconditional understanding and love that is amplified tenfold with each selfless act you bestow upon each other. You, every one of you, will match your amplified awareness with a similar harmonic emanating from the sanctuary of the universal mind. A matching of harmonics that becomes self-perpetuating awareness. You eventually reach a point where clarity is no longer the fruit of effort. Let me say that again. You reach a point where clarity is no longer a fruit of effort. You are the fruit of clarity. And so, beloved brothers and sisters, today, after this lecture, my next series of lectures will be dedicated primarily to the highest of spiritual and intellectual sciences. Yes, I will do the black news as I once did. And yes, I will critique current day affairs and all the stupidity that most of the aristocracy is carrying on with. But I don't wish to also preoccupy your precious attention with what amounts to being the temper tantrums and the death throes of a rapidly disintegrating, inevitably doomed consciousness paradigm. With that, I would like to pick up where I left off last time when we gathered together. During the time that we're going to spend together, I'm going to be popping up and down pretty readily. I had a little video that I wanted to show you. How many have seen the movie Dune?
Dune.
D-U-N-E. All right, I want you all to rent that movie. That's your homework for the week.
Part one?
Part one, not the crap they put on part two. Part one is interesting because it opens up. What was the date of the plane hitting? Put it in numbers.
9/11.
9/11. 01. Now, in the beginning of that movie, on the picture, in the very beginning, the daughter of the emperor comes on and makes a speech about what this whole movie is about. I want you to pay close attention to the date she says. Put the numbers down very large, and I wish I had it here for you, but put the numbers down very large on a piece of paper and put them separate. Put down 9-1-1-0-1, and then when you get the movie Dune, listen to the date she says that that movie or that particular story is taking place. And you tell me whether or not the Illuminati does not plan way in advance to screw with your mind, as well as with your life. I also want to just give some, some of the information up, that light, if it can. We just tap that out, because that one seems to be taking most of the, can everybody see that? It's a little better, right? Bill Cooper was assassinated, as we said last week, and as you all know. But he was assassinated immediately after a show he did. The show was on the whole history, including characters, of the operation with the aliens. The, what is the name of that? Majestic? MJ-12?
Yeah, Majestic 12.
Majestic 12. He broke the whole thing down from the 50s to the 70s, naming names, times, circumstances, and the dates. And he said at the end of it that he would most likely be killed for it. And he was. This information was damning to the undercover, the secret, blows the whole Project Blue Book out of the water. It completely illegitimates or delegitimizes Project Blue Book and puts everything out. Now, if you wish to order that tape, I would suggest you call the telephone number 801-759-1581. That's 759-1581. It's Bill Cooper's last broadcast before he was assassinated. They also tried to take Bill Cooper's money, but he had the money securely set away in a trust. And they've been trying their best to get it ever since, and they can't get to it. Because if they could get to it, that means they could get to everybody else in the trust, which means that nobody would trust the trust anymore. So it's an irrevocable, I think it was a pure trust. Okay? What I want to do at this point is to pick up where I left off. How many of you was at the last lecture? The last thing we showed was the picture of the smoke, check? All right, so let's just take it from that point and have a little fun. Now, if you remember correctly, and this is just a symbolism before we get started with the content, if you remember correctly, there was, okay, we have to turn out that other light too, if that's all right, because we're going to be able to hit that light behind, please. Thank you very much. Ah, that's better, right? Can everybody see that? All right. Remember when they told you that there was a little devil inside of that picture? And everybody was saying, oh Lord, we got a little devil inside the picture. And they even drew out the little devil. But it wasn't actually a little devil, as you will see. It's a cat. Now, I first want to make sure that you understand.
that after you were traumatized by 9/11, those doctors and scientists who run the MK Ultra and the Monarch Mind Control found it advantageous to now go to the advertising industry and begin with all the pictures involved in the 9/11 to start publishing embedded pictures of demons. So with all the new pictures that you might see of 9/11 after the event during this next time and ongoing throughout the next year or so, all of them will have airbrushed pictures within the smoke especially. You're going to see a lot of the pictures coming out with smoke as the primary content because it pretty much didn't have too much of a fire except the explosion. But the smoke will have specific archetypal demons or that which we as a species have been trained through generations to perceive as evil or as harmful to us. Okay? So, inside of a lot of the smoke pictures, you'll begin to see them begin to place archetypes, but one or two of them begin to go past your eye and you begin to see other pictures that they can't help but show you. This picture was the last picture I showed. This was the same picture they told you the cat or the little demon was in. But something just struck me as interesting because it didn't seem to me that the cat was the prevalent image. It seemed more to me that this was a brother. Here's the nose, here's the mouth, there's the eyes. And if you look deeply at it, it looks like an ancient or African depiction or carving of Ogun, the god of war. And if you look at it, and you keep looking at it enough, you'll see the face begin to jump right out at you. The other thing is, how many people used to look at those kinds of things that they had and just had a series of shapes on it, and then you had to stare at it long enough before the picture popped out at you almost three-dimensionally? That's what you have to do. You got to start using both sides of your brain when you start viewing pictures like these. You got to keep seeing into it, and then your mind and your brain is so easy to pick up superfluous information. Is very few can look at a whole mess of stuff and then completely get rid of all of the non-essentials and get right to the core of it. Well, that's how you have to start training your eyes if you want to see the subliminal embeds, is what they call it. Subliminal embeds they put into certain pictures. This one is a definite face of an African, but here, a picture was given to me by Brother Big Man. And something was troubling me about this picture, and I didn't know what it was until I got very sleepy doing my research. And I looked at it while I was tired, and bam, it came right out at me. It may not be as visible here, but I'm going to have the picture available for you when the time comes. Let me see if I'm on the right. Yeah. Okay. Now, inside of this smoke, it may be difficult to see it, but inside of this smoke, and I brought the picture here for you to look at. And I'm going to put it up here for you to look at it so that you can see it. When you get the chance during our halftime break, I want you to come up and I want you to take a look at this picture. And this is a big ass picture that they happen to release. All in its full glory. It's coming out. This is the picture that they released. And if you look in here, you will see the archetypal image of what we perceive as a demon. And you will see him. First his eye, his nose, his mouth, almost in a smiling position, and the two horns up there. wings, but this is a total face.
I'm talking about the wings on the side that, you know, the reptilian form of the wing. On the side.
Oh, on the side of the building. Yeah, it's kind of out of proportion. But this thing is just totally a huge face. You can pass that around if anybody wants to look at it. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, can anybody tell me what this is? Listen carefully. Gentlemen, what you just heard was harp. High active aerial auroral research project. A harp is a weapon. It is used by lifting or crystallizing the ionosphere and bouncing signals around it, around the world. It changes the weather. It destroys crops. It destroys mines. What you were listening to was a subsonic sound that was brought to the surface. This is what your inner being hears every now and then when they pulse it at you. This is what can cause fights, bring down planes, destabilize information that you think are your thoughts. People listening to this sometimes get ill to their stomachs and throw up. Some people get headaches about an hour later and don't know why. But I brought it to you so that now that it's on the surface, and what I wanted to do was for you to associate the feeling that you get when you heard it audibly. Because sometimes you don't know how to process the feelings you get when you are being bombarded by it inaudibly. Do you understand what I just said? The reason why I let you hear harp was so that the audible part of your conscious mind could now relate the feeling of what you're hearing so that that feeling, if it comes up the next time, you know where it's coming from when it's inaudibly working on you. All right? There are ways to do things that you could get past it, like using certain magnets in different areas of your head. You can work it. More things for us to think on. How many people saw Die Hard? Isn't it interesting how they can tell you what they're getting ready to do and you won't even pick up on it? Check?
Check.
I mean, saw Die Hard 2. Uh-huh. We went from a buildings to an airport. Check the check the points where the spotlights are. Precisely the point where they hit Tower 1. Damn near the point where they hit Tower 2. and the brain. We're not looking at the archetypal imagery that we're getting. It's funny, if they reverse this, it would almost look like the plane was going right into the tower. But of course, your mind will associate it anyway. Your mind will associate it. We look at things and we don't know what we're looking at. Evidence that everyone knew, especially in the government, what was going on. Evidence that here's evidence that some niggas can be crazy. Some niggas are just out of their mind. That's a disgrace. Here's something interesting for you to look at. This came out in Newsweek magazine. And check the title. Now, these words are not telling you what could be, but they are trying to drive home what you should be thinking. Check now. This Thanksgiving, Americans will gather, overeat, cuddle, and be what? Especially grateful for what we've got. What do we have? We have a little black boy dressed as a damn pilgrim. Now, you want to see a grateful nigga? Now that's a real grateful looking nigga right there. Father Russell Dillon of St. Augustine Roman Catholic Church in Washington will preach this weekend. But I want you to check out what they say at the bottom. Amazing grace. Spiritually, counts these days. 21% of Americans plan to get more involved with their religion after 9/11. During the holidays, pastors say that attendance, which spiked as much as 30% in the 2 weeks following, people are running back to church. Was there a plan involved to do just that? Oh, later on this afternoon, we are going to explore that very seriously. September 11th has started to level off. Weeks following September 11th has started to level up. Crunch, which operates 19 yoga studios nationwide, says attendance is up 30% since 9/11. One of the biggest candle producers in the country has seen a jump in sales since the attacks. Visits the religious website, BeliefNet, soared in September and were at least 5% higher than usual in October, especially popular gratitude message boards, where people can give thanks anonymously. It is surely the most American of holidays, rooted in the stony soil of New England and still sending forth nearly 400 years exotic blossoms of pageantry and gluttony. Thanksgiving, which raises the humble pursuit of pleasure to the level of religious duty, teaches that we are all after the same things in life: the love of our family, the warm furnace, the sweet repose of home, and some of that crispy skin just behind the drumstick, guiltily plucked from the rabbit's carcass before it disappears under 17 linear feet of aluminum foil. In contrast to spirits in death, which celebrates the abstract ideals of salvation and liberty, Thanksgiving is about what? Feeling good right now. So, and right now is the, and that's what America needs it. Even with the good news from the battlefield last week, in the face of recession, an unprecedented attack on the homeland and the nation was gripped by comfort fever. And you niggas kept dressing your little black children up. Can you imagine that shit? That's a disgrace. I can't understand how black people after Malcolm, I mean, just after the 60s, could still be doing that to their children. Here's something interesting. Nike, who is one of the most powerful people, corporations on the planet, was about to release a sneaker. And the name of the sneaker was called Incubus. Anybody clue that what an incubus is? What is an incubus?
It's a demon.
It's a demon. A demon that screws you while you sleep. Now they said, oh, we didn't know. Oh, how could that have happened? Lying sacks of shit. They knew what it was. They thought the women who would be buying this didn't know what it was. But here you would have a sneaker that would have an energy in it that women would be wearing, and then a whole other set of complaints is going to start coming up. These are just the surface gains here we're going to deal with, and we're going to get on to it. Just to bring you up to this so you can keep looking. You think that Bush wanting his war powers tribunal is new? There's nothing new about it. Had him going on for a long while. This was a man, a Japanese man, who was tried in secret. And after his trial, he was executed in secret. These are the kinds of things that this particular government is already structured to do. They already got courts underground in silos, places where courts would be working. They already got all of that. Now, isn't it interesting also that the tower image, you wondered why they ever chose anthrax as the specific disease of choice that they were going to work on you with? Off-tackle images? How did they tell you that the World Trade Center was built? No, how was it built? I mean, what was the structure built like? The inner core was a circle of iron. Check. Right? So, they broke down anthrax. Now, I understand this got to be it, but are we looking at all of the prototypes that keep us locked into a fear, and we are now focusing in on things like anthrax? Are they plotting to play the game when the time comes, as we are slowly trying to come out of our fear? All of the fact that that particular thing happened to those towers in front of us at the time to traumatize our psyche, are all of the subsequent archetypal images of those two pillars of long columns, whatever, are they going to be constantly driven home as something that is dangerous, something to fear, something they're going to work on nerves with? Sowing the seeds of redemption. Could war and terrorist attack help us achieve richer, more fulfilling lives? Listen to what they're saying now. Are they asking the question for us to answer it? Or is that something rhetorical? Do we need to constantly be at war, they say, because it seems now that everybody is getting friendlier. They done killed 3, 4, 5, 6,000, and we all not love one another. Do you need us to kill 6,000 more? Just tell us. Let us know you want to go to war, because we know that we're telling you that once you go to war, we live richer, more fulfilling lives. Shared threats foster intense social engagement. American GIs host a dinner for English children during World War II. Hey, the benevolent killer. Just some things that make you say, Your children. Oh, how I hate to get up. Sit back, he tells you. Relax, while sales of VCRs and camcorders drop nationwide for October, at St. Paul's TV, the king of the big screen in Los Angeles, Paul Golden being Goldenberg is selling as many as, what? 150 big screen televisions on any given Saturday. Double the business of a year ago. Everybody now want to go inside. Theme park attendance is in the dumps, with admissions to Disney World diving 25% for the quarter ending September 30th. Jolly Time Popcorn says that microwave sales for August, September, and October increased more than 25% over the same quarter year. Video and DVD rentals and sales are up dramatically over a year ago, with special credit going to the Shrek. Shrek, which generated $110 million in sales its first weekend out. Country singer Lee Greenwood, whoever the hell that is, all these people now are making money, but I want you to see how they're playing you every time they depict a television for your child. What is the archetype that you're seeing right there? Look at the picture. Tell me what you see. Because later on, all of this is going to start making sense. All right? Look like you got on a dress. Excuse me. I want you to pay close attention to the TV set. What movie is out right now? What? Monsters Incorporated. And who is the character of Monsters Incorporated? But a little walking eye with legs, check. We're going to find out who that eye is and why they got it walking around just to maintain your attention. Of course, I showed this before. They tell you, just imagine it. They tell you, just imagine it. Let's just imagine that. Just imagine it. What does it say here? Memory stick. Think they're catching up to the Matrix? They tell you to imagine, they say, nah. Never happened. But then, I showed you this the last time. An ant carries a 1 millimeter microchip in its mandibles as a promotional photograph released by Huddersfield University Precision Technology Center. The center says, It's the first in Britain to calibrate measurements and instrument at 1/10,000th of a millimeter. This is a microchip, an information processor that is in the mandibles of an ant. Of an ant. Let's see. Pretty soon they can upload you with air and you can read. So a lot of people have a tendency that when they see it, they're not paying attention to the little things that I'm trying to open up into people's minds about how we are being manipulated. Let's go a little further. Does anybody remember this? The original one. What's wrong with that one there?
Doesn't have the double lines.
Ah. Notice what was missing? A lot of you are too young to recognize the time when they had took that one stripe away. There were two stripes on the S. It was an old Phoenician symbol. What is that? There were two stripes on it. And one was taken away when your gold and your silver was taken away. That is an ancient Phoenician symbol for the parallels. The ancient Phoenician coin had two towers with a snake wrapped up between them. The coin itself, or the towers themselves, were the place where the sun would come through and cast a shadow that would give time and seasonal change and references. This was the way that we clocked consciousness as it took its route through all of the signs of the zodiac. And people who had an understanding of how these two pillars worked were given the dividends, were paid in consciousness, were given great things by which to incorporate themselves more deeply into the upper universes. Paramount of which would have been this. That came from an ancient stellium, where you see the Masonic hand, the pomegranate, which is the symbol of all of us together in this as one. Anybody ever ate a pomegranate? They got thousands of seeds in there, around one head. That's what that meant. I'm giving you all the archetypes. Now when you saw the dollar bill, this is one of the Illuminati symbols that came or preceded this. You know they had to take the serpent out of that one. The French still use the simple high. But your dollar bill and the symbol for money, which is not, this is not the symbol for dollars because it's not complete. This became the symbol for what?
Medicine.
No. Whenever you see them tell you that this is a dollar sign with a stripe through it, it's not a dollar sign, it's a credit sign. So, no longer do you use money, because if you were using real money, there'd be two stripes through it. Everything that you're using now is based upon credit. So it's essentially just one stripe. Okay? How many like Mickey Mouse? When they were young. How many liked Disney when they were young? And they had a good time, didn't they? Didn't you just love Disney? You ever watched his name? Huh? You ever looked at his name? All you people who love Walt Disney? Can y'all see that? Walt Disney was not only a pedophile, not only a pornographer, but he was a Satanist. And what do we have with Walt Disney? Huh? Watch me carefully.
Right.
666. It's in his name. So every time you take your child to see one of these here prophecy. I mean, saw Lion King. I know every black man, black woman, black child saw Lion King. I mean, saw Lion King. Don't start lying. You were crying too when you thought that daddy died. And... yes, you did. I liked it too, but when I saw the word sex come up in the smoke. Oh. Oh, y'all didn't get that one yet? Oh, you got to get that one. I want you to go get the Lion King. Study the Lion King one more time. And pick up on the part where you see, I believe it was him looking off at his father, or what his father might have been, up into the smoke, when the smoke went up in the air. And as the smoke went up in the air, you saw the word sex. Then you're taking your 2 and 3 and 4 year old child to see a movie that's got the word sex coming up there, playing with your mind like that. Yeah. How many people have taken sign language here? How many people know what sign language is? Huh? Give me the sign for I love you. Oh, you know it, huh? Anybody else know what I love you? Right. Who you saying you love it to? You ever see the Rockers?
Right. Funk sound, yeah.
Everybody know what that means? It could mean that. Could mean that. You're right. You own it. I mean, you know, hell. Hell yeah, it could mean the devil. Sure could mean the devil to me. But it actually is the symbol and the sign from the dollar. Y'all paying attention? It's the symbol and the sign from inside a dollar. You can open up, get yourself a dollar, get yourself a big magnifying glass, and look up into the right corner at the shield. I don't want to tell you where the shield is from, but Vatican shield, which is part of the Rothschild shield. Look up right in that corner, and you will see right there in the corner a little owl. The symbol of Moloch. Moloch in your Bible is the one who sacrificed and devoured children. Over 200,000 children were disappeared in the last 2 years. Where he went to? Where are the children being taken to? The symbol of the owl, or the symbol of Moloch, or the symbol of the Bohemians, is that. And it is the owl. You see the owl? There's his head, and that's his tail. And he's sitting right up in that little dollar, looking and peering out, observing the wise. So you say, well, that don't mean nothing. I mean, what could that possibly mean? Well, you ask him. The reason why I was telling you Negroes up there playing their sax, Cecily Tyson tying her head off looking like she's the only one gonna work in the kitchen after everything is said and done. Dancing and buck dancing and jigger-booing. That's why Khalid was probably gonna go all the way the fuck off if he was alive for that shit to happen. Because, I mean, these Negroes were buck dancing. You saw it. I showed it to you. Buck dancing Negroes. I'm going to dig that shit up again, boy, because it's laughable to watch these niggas. And you know, once you done told them niggas, you know you're going to be on TV, they hurried up and shined that sax up. They hurried up and got, you know, clean. Some of the niggas probably went and got a haircut. We playing for Bill Clinton. We love you, Bill. you say, well, it must be only Bill. Check.
Check.
No!
That's a double.
Now, I want you to see the difference. There are two different ways. One deals with the owl itself. How? With the tongue. Others deal directly with the goat. You notice he didn't put his stomach. And then when I showed you the fact in the earlier piece that they're two different ways. You see the demon doing it too. Right here. How many were here when I told you that Art Bell was government? Art Bell? Told you Art Bell was government. But you said, nah. I told you he was skull. No. And y'all listening? Art Bell. Huh? He says this is the family crest. He'd be joking, of course. He'd think everybody thinks he's joking. He says this is the family crest. He says these are the family colors. He said, this is my favorite shirt. But then you say, well, shit, anybody can get a goddamn thing with skull and bones on it, right? But how many can actually get his damn ID? But here's the other thing. What's his name?
Art Bell.
Art Bell? Really? Is that what he told you? It don't say Art Bell there. It says William S. Daly. Who the fuck is William S. Daly? Take a good look at it. But check the name on it. Could he be part of Majestic 12? Sent out by the CIA for disinformation? Is he a point of reference for all the people who do have experiences such as the kind that we're going to be having commonly? But those people who are genuine, he is there to, what? Make sure that those people are siphoned out the same way that the CIA set up a television show called Sightings in order to filter all those damn fools who wanted to call in and talk about their experiences. That was CIA. Sightings and a couple of them other ones. All set up by the government to get the people to start responding because there was more and more so-called UFO activities that nobody could explain. And like I said, of course, is it just me? I mean, hey, Art Bell? Everybody loved Art Bell. Art Bell was telling us all the deals around the aliens, man. Shit, now who's gonna tell us the real deal? Yeah, I'll do my best. I'll tell you. Where were we before? When I showed you, and this is the good part when I can get the pictures together so that along the proof and corroborative information. What happened with the little child that I showed you? What was that television looking like, huh? What was my boy again? The movie, Monsters Incorporated, where did they get the theme from? story is supposed to be about the rescue of this little girl from out of the monster's grasp. But this archetypal symbol, what looks like legs coming from it, is going to be around for a long time. Of course, you see CBS, but what they got to do is they got to start training children to become more accustomed to the type of Illuminati archetypal symbology that will motivate them. That's who all these Pokemons are. The Pokemons are to get them situated in their minds to accept more data relating to the Illuminati as commonplace. Because everything is busting wide open now. There's nothing that they can hide anymore. They got to come face front. So now they have to make the children not be shocked, or the parents not be shocked, at when they begin to see this type of symbology. They must now just relate it. This is part of a total scheme of things, but I took it and broke it off so you could see what it is that they're playing on the minds of our children with. This is 33rd degree Inspector General, Knight Commander, Court of Honor, Sublime Prince of the Royal Secret. When you see this two-headed symbol here with the eagle, there is a new car that just came on the market that has this symbol on the gas cap. I tried to track it down so I can run after it to catch it, but it went in the other direction. I want you all to be clocking it. It's the brand new 2002. It is this very symbol with the twin-headed birds. It's supposed to be twin dragons or twin eagles going in the opposite direction. This very symbol with a tail, looks like a dragon, two-headed dragons with a tail, is on the new car, on the gas cap. The Illuminati now are coming out, and they must allow you time to become accustomed with the new symbols. You was accustomed with Lady Liberty, you were accustomed with Uncle Sam, you were accustomed to all of the different symbols that you got with, well, they done took one from you, and when it has crashed at the World Trade Center, but all of the different symbols. Oh, by the way, some of the most potent anti-Illuminati sites are now shutting down. One dude left a letter and a note stating that he had to leave because of fear of his life and his family's life. The Illuminati, I forgot what they call it, the Illuminati Papers, Illuminati Chronicles, there are about two or three sites that was covering the Illuminati are now shutting down. So I would suggest you get up on the site as quick as possible and start downloading a lot of that old information that some of these crackers were putting out on each other. Get it now, because that information now, they're gonna start what they call sanitizing the web. Washington District of Criminals, the White House, the symbol of who? The Bohemians. They have a place that they go up that they sacrifice to the gods. We showed you this particular symbol here. The last time, you remember, for those who weren't here, this particular symbol is the symbol of Freemasonry. Anuetus Coeptus. If you look at the Anuetus, easy to see. Maybe I'll give it to you in this one. And you can see it there. Now, when you look at the Anuetus Coeptus, the Anuet Coeptus, Novus Ordo Seclorum, our enterprise is crowned with success, the New World Order, bada bada bee, bada bee. You get MDCCLXXVI. That's supposed to be what, 1776. You have the words Novus Ordo Seclorum and Anuet Coeptus, but hidden within the value of the words, or the way the words are set up, the words M-A-S-O-N is set up in those. M-A-S-O-N. I'll show it to you again. You got that? M A S O N. Got it? For those of you who are not here, I'm just reviewing some reviews for you. Also, at the bottom, you will see that the numbers M D C L X V I. The M, of course, means Mason. The D is 500. C is 100, which equals 600. L is 50, 10 is 10, which equals 60, V is 5, 1 is 1, 6, we got 600, 60, and 6. That's not an accident, brothers and sisters. How many people know what the Tower cards are about? Ever heard of the Tower? The Tarot. Okay, do you know that they have a new Tarot out and they've now changed the Tower? That is the new Tower card. The new Tower card is crumbling and it looks exactly like the World Trade Center with the plane. The words are set up like the plane. This is the Tower. You see it falling apart the same way that you saw it. It is now going to be an ingrained archetypal image in your mind. They are going to work that even at the metaphysical level. When you go for your reading, When Ms. Cleo says, Calmino! And if they have to show it to you, they'll show you the Tower card. The new Tower card will be the falling of that particular card in Babylon. Now, I'm doing all of this preliminarily because we're about to get to work on something that is going to be extremely disturbing about information surrounding who it is that is actually and truly been manipulating us all along, has been at the crux and behind who we have been fighting. We have been, as black people, fighting a surface enemy that was given to us. When we begin to unravel who it is, there are so many layers that we get tired of digging and we get satisfied at fighting at the level that we feel comfortable at. We don't want to go to levels where it becomes uncomfortable to fight. Very few take the next step to go into those levels and then to confront the beast that's feeding the upper levels. That's difficult. It takes a lot of work. Ladies and gentlemen, don't be surprised, this will be a reality someday. They are already starting the building. Friends of mine in the military told me they're putting up thatch houses left and right. They've closed down military bases, and we will investigate why they've closed down these military bases later on. But the closing of these military bases have a purpose. There is a reason for closing them. Because on them right now, in underground silos, as well as up above in certain areas where they're experimenting on the building of space stations, and wherever they have shut down military bases, the wide open spaces now have these thatch houses that can go up in a day. Whole fields of minute houses go up, and the military is building them. Army Corps of Engineers are building them. And the engineers from different militaries are coming over here to build them. Do you know that there now is on the Congress floor plans to be passed, to pass a bill where they will begin construction of a maximum security prison under the ocean? There are maximum security prison plans for under the ocean. They can't warehouse enough Negroes on the surface. So we are talking about sending them underwater and shooting them up into outer space. This is where everything is going right now with the so-called New World Order. There is a project at this very time. You may want to check out a little bit longer the different places. Of course, Greenfield, South Carolina. You got Montgomery, Alabama. I'm not sure where that is. Up there in New York. El Paso, Texas. Evansport, Wisconsin, Rice Lake, West Virginia, up to the right, okay, West Virginia. You have Wickenburg, Florence, Safford, Tucson. You have four of them bastards around Arizona. The government has the names of 1 million citizens, one of every 200, ready to be transferred via computers from the memory banks to arrest warrants that have already been printed. They have arrest warrants already printed for specific people that they'll draw. Sometimes, if they don't have specific people that are in the community raising hell and heaven, they'll start picking you like they picked the draft. This is serious, because it's getting ready to happen. It's already on the move. September 11th said, after everybody started ducking and saying, they got you punks running. I said, we got them good now. We can tell these motherfuckers anything now. Because when you've been traumatized, you are looking for comfort. So they've been building Bush as your daddy. He's gonna protect y'all. Don't worry, we're gonna be all right. Daddy Bush gonna be all right. He gonna make sure that everything go away, including you. Put this in your mind. It's called Project Lucid. There is a hidden establishment at this very time. The computer in Washington, D.C. is 5 stories high. There's no offices, no desks, maybe 1 or 2 offices in the first floor or in the top floor, but the rest of the building is a computer. And every name of every person on this planet is in there. And it can assign a number to each one of those people in 3 hours. So what's this war all about? A lot of people, when we start talking about aliens and shit, they say, oh, come on. But even the ancestors knew that there was a war going on, and the war was between symbolic energies that manifested themselves, and when they manifested themselves, we, through our perception, related them to different animals, to different events, the different seasons. Supposedly, there's a war going on between the reptilians and some entities they call the felines. That means. But I can't help but when I'm moving around looking at stuff and investigating and digging and trying to prod for information, stuff comes up when you look in earnest. And I looked in earnest and I began to see that there are certain symbols that we are looking at, or we are not allowed to look at, that appear. And I begin to wonder there some kind of credibility?
Right.
To what's going on?
Same type of outline.
Now, this is an official Marine Corps emblem. This is an official Marine Corps. Let me say that again. That is an official Marine Corps emblem. This is from the Marine Corps Warfighting Laboratory. They have what looks like a spacecraft right here. They have an F-15 fighter. They have a landing barge, which you couldn't see here, but I don't know if I brought the actual symbol. But inside of all of that, they have who? Now, what country has the symbol of the dragon? Hold that thought for later. All of what I'm showing you now is to get you prepared for what's getting ready to come. So pay attention to every little thing I'm saying to you, because it's all going to relate later. I want to show you another one. Again, another patch, official patch. There's the ship again. There's that helio. That's that. I don't know. This is the Osprey. The Osprey, they call it. This has just been crashing all over the damn place. But they still got it up here. They got the Marine looking, and they got the wolf next to him, behind him. You know they've been domesticating wolves and uploading the wolves with certain types of behavioral modification chips? Now, dogs are just bad enough. Wolves, with their intelligence as well, using an archetypal native symbol of power and energy to assist you or to assist the dragon. Now, the deep part about it is the dragon is a spirit in this one. Barely visible, but there anyway. And it's so interesting that he looks just like that prototype piece. But wait a minute. What is all that landing? Because what happens is they don't show you who he's looking at. What was he looking at? Let's go back to the other one. Remember, it's almost the same thing. Check.
Check.
But look, what is he looking at? Houses. Who's he attacking? Who's he going after? These are houses. This looks like a peaceful little village where people fish.
Looks like Chinese houses.
Look like something on the Mediterranean or right there on anybody else's coast. Look like a pair of beach houses. Our children are not taught the true history of this country. In fact, it's tantamount to teach them a version of history. There's something else that I dug up on the military. What does this mean? Listen very carefully. Watch very carefully, people. Existing doctrine. I don't know what SOP is. Anybody know? I know. Standard Operational Procedure, right? Okay. And TTPs. Anybody know what TTPs are? Tactical training programs. Huh?
Procedures.
Okay, procedures. Here you have the war lab patch. Check. Three limited objective experiments, culminating phase experiment, advanced warfare experiment.
Twin Towers again.
Wait a minute, are we looking at what we're seeing here? This is an official release by the military. Let me go over this again. existing doctrines, standard operating procedures, and technical
training
procedures. Right. Urban, what's that say?
Urban warrior.
Urban warrior. Urban warrior. Urban warrior? Now, I ain't gonna be no National Guard. The National Guard haven't got no dragon looking over the city. You're damn right, look like Godzilla. But then they tell you that the urban warrior has three limited objective experiments culminating in phase experiments. What's the phase experiment? What's the three limited objectives? Advanced Warfare Experiment, AWE. All. And what's the place that they show you that they're going to do this advanced warfare experiment? At the Twin Towers. Joint Contingency Force, AWE, Millennium Dragon, Capable Warfare, Advanced Warfare Experiment, Combat Development System. Now, it all comes from here. Doctrine, organization, training, education, equipment, facilities, and support. All this going here to the operating forces. But what did this say here?
The
X-Files. And it's the dragon. But what does that all mean? Who are these people? I'm going to show you who these people are. Take a look at your new soldier. That is your new wartime Marine Army. This is who they are going to be. This is who you're going to meet in the street. They got a chance to meet them in Washington, D.C. when they pulled them out during that time when they were marching against the globalization. G7 and all the rest of them, that's when they pulled them out. But you didn't see them specifically because they had them in limited operations. But let me just tell you what this man is. Check what it says up here. Read down there. Read this. What you see is a soldier system that gives me how much? 360 degree vision in what?
Pitch black.
Makes me invisible to the naked eye. Lets me walk up mountainsides. How many used to come to my gathering of the masters? About 10, 15 years ago. How many was there when Preston Nichols came? Not many of you are. Wait, you were there. You were there? Preston Nichols, big fat white dude.
Yes, okay.
Let me just give you an idea of who Preston Nichols was. Preston Nichols was one of the people who worked on the Montauk Project. Anybody ever heard of Montauk?
Yeah.
All right. Anybody ever heard of Al Bielek?
Yeah.
Al Bielek was down with the Philadelphia Experiment. One day, Preston said that he and a couple of his people went into Montauk Park, the area that they had closed down. And during the time they were in there, they were going around trying to find out what was all this activity in an installation that he used to head at one time. Why was there activity in there, and what was going on in there with all the discordant energy signatures that he was getting inside of a lot of his equipment. He went inside, he said, of the park. And when he went inside the park, he was walking towards one of the places, one of the bunkers, and all of a sudden, one of the bushes came alive and a man appeared out of nowhere. Now, at the time, I have to go into my archives because he gave me a film when they snuck in themselves and took a picture of this guy in his stealth uniform or on his stealth situation. They have the ability to make text disappear. They have the ability to have you looking at them, and since the eyes need a specific wavelength energy to be able to focus on an object, they have packs that they carry on their back that allow them to distort the atmosphere that is immediately around them, so that when you look at them, the distortion is simply like you looking on a hot desert where you look at the waves of the heat. That's what you see. That's what you see. You don't see them. You don't see the outline, because the eyes need an outline. They need to feel, the eyes need to see specific signatures of light and color in order to register something onto the brain. The eyes need that for the brain to work. They found a way to distort the signals going into the brain so that the person who is distorting the area looks invisible. That technology was talked about some 15 to 20 years ago when Preston Nichol spoke about it, and that a lot of it had to do with some of the experiments that he himself conducted. That he himself conducted, and they took it from him. Of course, I told you what that meant. You read it. I've made a larger series of it for you. But you say, this guy has to have his own common sense. He took an oath to the Constitution. Check. It don't matter. Look at him. He's got, his name is Patterson. Has his name right up there. A helmet that can have him see 360 degrees behind him, beside him, wherever you are. Can make him invisible. The suit that he has on can make him invisible. An army of one, essentially. But if you look at the symbol, what is the symbol of the U.S. Army?
Star.
Not just any star.
Star.
Not just any star. It's the pentagram.
Pentagram, yeah. Two stars. Okay.
It's the goat. Check. But you say, this man was educated in America, apple pie, mom. What can we possibly fear? We got a smoking soldier now. He's out to protect us. Well, guess what? A while back, this particular survey was given at the 29 Palms Marine Corps Base in California. DD Form 3206, RB-296, Joint Services Training Combat Army Arms Survey, Part A, confidential when filled in. This questionnaire is to gather data concerning the attitudes of combat trained personnel with regard to non-traditional missions. All responses are confidential and official. Write your answers directly in the form. In part two, place an X in the space provided for your response. Date, blah, 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 bing. And let's go up here and just get an idea of what's going on. They ask you, you know, where did you spend most of your childhood? How many months did you serve? Operation Desert Storm, Desert Shield. Highest level of education. See, bada bing, 12, bang, 16, more than 16. Mm-hmm. What? Attitude? How did it come right from your, what do you call it, to your attitude? Hmm? Do you feel that U.S. combat troops should be used within the U.S. and bordering countries for any of the following missions? Now, there is a law called Posse Comitatus. And that law states that no military, U.S. military, may be used upon U.S. citizens. You can't pull the U.S. military. How many people saw Siege? We spoke about Posse Comitatus, right? Strongly disagree, disagree, agree, strongly agree, no opinion. Should we be using personnel through drug enforcement, disaster relief, security at national events, environmental disaster cleanup, including toxic and nuclear? substitute teachers, and school workers in public school. Community assistance programs, landscaping, environmental cleanup, road repair, animal control, federal and state prison guards, and auxiliary police, national emergency police, international security force. Wait a minute, international security force? Which means they could bring anybody over here.
They have them here already.
That's right. They got the Russians already in Pennsylvania.
That's right.
They got the Japanese already in Florida. They got the Chinese in California.
They're here already.
Wait, listen, get better. As what? Advisors to SWAT. Could you imagine? This man, an advisor to SWAT? Border Patrol, drug enforcement and interdiction? That means they could kick your door in if you got a grandma or her? What? Wait now, look. Peacekeeping and what? What's happening today? Look at your airports. Do you feel that U.S. combat troops should be used in other countries under command of non-U.S. officers appointed by the where? UN? For drug enforcement, disaster relief, environmental relief, peacekeeping, including law enforcement and security, national building, police action. What did I tell you? Look carefully, brothers and sisters. Who was here at the last one when I told you that there is no such thing as us going to war anymore? Why can't we go to war? No. As a nation, why can't we go to war? Why can't we declare war?
Bankrupt.
Say it again.
Bankrupt.
Because we are bankrupt. So when this Bush was speaking about us going to war to end terrorism, the war on terrorism, the war, what he was doing was simply putting his stamp on the War Powers Act, because every time a president, quote unquote, declares war, he brings back into effect the War Powers Act that was started back in Lincoln's time, that was never taken off during Lincoln's time. So every president subsequent to that declares war on some bullshit entity. The war on drugs, the war on poverty, the war on AIDS.
Yes.
All they have to do is say, we're going to war on something. And you become prisoners of war. Because remember, the establishment of a central banking system in the United States' land was against the Constitution, and therefore a hostile act against the people of the United States of America. What they had to do was turn you, the people, into the enemy of the government. And that's what they do every time he pronounces war on something. And he reactivates the War Powers Act on you. He turns you into the enemy. So, when I told you that there couldn't be any war, proof shows you on this very military piece of material, what? They say, should the military be used in times of this, but here it is in, should the military be used in a police action? And what do they use as an example?
Vietnam. That's a storm.
So what is this war in Vietnam? What is this war in Korea? What is this war in Desert Storm and in Iraq? There were no wars. Thousands and thousands of your children died in a police action. That's like sending these motherfuckers over here from the precincts into someplace in the hood, and thousands of them ain't coming home. And finally, this is the same survey. Look at what they asked. you to put down.
Yes or no?
What does it say? I feel no, there is no conflict between my oath of office and serving as a UN soldier? Your oath states that you will defend and protect the United States from all enemies, foreign and domestic. That means that you no longer are dealing with your constitutional oath. In other words, if there is no conflict between your oath, there was no oath. You have now abrogated the oath in lieu of becoming a UN soldier, a conscript for the world orders, whoever it is that they deem. I feel a designated unit of U.S. combat soldiers should be permanently assigned to the command and control of the UN. I would be willing to volunteer for assignment to a U.S. combat unit under a what? UN commander. I would like the UN member countries, including the US, to give the UN all the soldiers necessary to maintain world peace. Huh? I would swear to the following code. Listen, I am a United Nations fighting person. I serve in the forces which maintain world peace and every nation's way of life. I swear and affirm to support and defend the Charter of the United Nations, and I am prepared to give my life in its defense. This is the very thing that they tell you to do with the Constitution. The U.S. government declares a ban on the possession, sale, transport, and transfer of all non-approved firearms. A 30-day amnesty period is established for these firearms to be turned over to the local authority. At the end of this period, a number of irregular citizen groups and defiant individuals refuse to turn them over, their own firearms, to authority. Consider the following statement. I would fire upon U.S. citizens who refuse or resist confiscation of their firearms banned by the United States government. Yes or no?
Don't they say you're supposed to, the Second Amendment?
Is the situation getting a little more tense for you? Because what are you looking at right now? This survey was 96, remember? We are in 2002 here. Are we getting a little worried yet? No? All right. That's all right. That's all right.
Y'all gonna be cool about it. Some of y'all are real cool. I like the fact y'all are cool.
This interagency memo was sent out by your Attorney General, Ashcroft, and it came out from Arizona. Federal Bureau of Investigation released this little document for all those concerned.
Let's see if I can find the rest of it here.
And the little document had those pieces of material on it, and I'm trying to find out if I brought those. I may not have. If I didn't, then I would have to tell you what was in it.
Okie by dokie.
All right. On the other side of this document . The FBI's Joint Task Force is attempting to identify criminal activities with the terrorists. In this regard, the purpose of this information sheet is to assist uniformed patrol officers in identifying potential domestic terrorism. Domestic terrorism is defined as groups or individuals operating entirely inside the United States attempting to influence the U.S. government or population to affect political and social change by engaging in criminal activity. In the event questionable activity is encountered, contact the individuals named in this for clarification. Now, what I don't have, and I didn't have, was what it is to look for. Animal rights activists. Black separatist groups. People who keep saying, according to my constitutional rights. Wait now, did you hear what I just said? They said to identify a terrorist, one of the ways is a person constantly declaring their constitutional rights. It's not a joke. It is not a joke. We are on real time at this point. The people that I have just introduced you to at this point are those people who are in charge at this very moment. Now, how many of you have been watching CNN? How many of you saw it? How many of you saw the Bin Laden interview? Was that some comical shit or was that some comedy shit? I mean, they are getting desperate. They are getting desperate. I'm telling you, Bin Laden, that wasn't Bin Laden, first of all. Because whoever that was, my boy was eating good. Now, he's supposed to be in the desert starving and a soldier, lean, mean, fighting machine. My boy looked like he'd been sitting back with all kinds of Jiffy Pop, watching the war on TV like everybody else. Now, who saw the interview? Tell me what you knew was wrong from giddy jump. Go ahead.
It was US words.
He was talking a lot of times, words were being printed on the bottom of the screen and his mouth wasn't even.
Yeah! Not only that, when he was talking in the Arabs who was looking at it, when he was talking in the Arabic tongue, the words he was saying wasn't matched with the way his mouth was supposed to work. And all the other Bin Laden videos were clear as bells. Have you ever seen them? They was crisp. You could see the pimples. You could even smell the sweat. Smell the goat meat. But as soon as my man declares that he did it,
excuse me, Miss Honorable.
What kind of shit is that? Yo, that's my son, boy.
Give him a hand.
Drops out, you can't see it, light gets flashed. What kind of shit is that? He's in a cave, but you hear the commentators putting, yes, we zapped it to them and we really got them. Didn't we get them? And you know, we'd like to thank you for all the weapons you gave us. And you know, when we killed them, didn't we do a good job? Come on, who's writing this shit? Not only that, here's the other part of it. What did he say about the other terrorists?
They didn't know what they were doing.
Say it again? Mm.
They didn't know
what they were doing. Check. They didn't know they were going on that mission to see Allah.
Until they got in the plane.
No, wait. Have you been following this dumbass? Whoever the writer is on this shit, he should be shot with a shit gun. Check it. Didn't we hear earlier that one of the terrorists' suitcase was found? Conveniently, you leave it on a damn plane, but your suitcase is left. Okay? In the suitcase was a letter telling the man's wife that he was on a mission and that he was doing it for the glory of Allah and his people and the whole nine yards. Did he not tell you, or did they not release the shit that told you that those people getting on that plane knew what the fuck was going on? Now they come back and tell you that Bin Laden said, we done sent them dumbass motherfuckers in there. You know what it was to do? It was to get the rest of the Arab world pissed off with him.
Yeah.
And that don't even look like Bin Laden. It looked like a Bin Laden lookalike. Somebody with a hand up his ass moving his mouth.
It also looks so bad. It looks like they had to stop the film.
Yes, I had to stop it. You put a little more makeup on here and it says, cut! Action! Who is writing this shit? They really think we some dumb fools. But guess what happened? Just yesterday, I'm getting a video. I got one of my soldiers tape the CNN interview. I mean, after they showed the tape, the dumb motherfuckers at CNN opened up the lines for people to call in and tell them what they thought. Whoa! Bad mistake! It was coming bang, bang! Bullshit! Are you kidding? Who is writing this shit? That's all it always. And they should see the commentator. Nervous? Thank you very much. Click! Cut the motherfuckers off! I'm gonna get that tape. I'm gonna get that tape. I wish I had it ready today. It would have been funny as hell. I left it home. But it was funny as hell because the soldier that was taping it for me was laughing like hell saying, you should see. And the thing is, if you saw it the first time, you would see how nervous the person who was conducting the phone interviews was when you looked at it the first time. But if you look at it a second and third time, you can't pick it up or detect it as much. So the impact would be good if you saw it immediately. The people, hey, I was doing my laundry. And I buy all kind of shit. You know, it's, I see time, and I want to show you something on time in a minute. But I buy time, I snitch some shit, and I buy all this stuff so I can look at all the juicy shit they got in there. I'm buying this stuff, and I picked it up. Little dude. Comes to me and says, so what do you think about that? And I'm looking at him, and I'm saying, oh, shit. Motherfuckers are following me all around now. And I'm waiting, I'm looking for the cameras and shit. I'm looking for motherfuckers in the car with the shit, and, you know, look, pick it up. So I look around, and I'm saying, oh, what do you think of it? I said, you know. It's a good show. He said, what? I said, it's a good show. He said, well, he said, don't you know who this is? And they were saying American Taliban. That's what it said on the cover. I don't know what it meant on who this man was. I didn't even give a shit. But it's amazing. He said, you don't know about it? He said, I said, no, I don't know. He said, you don't know about the Afghan war? I said, not really. So he said, well, what do you think about, you know, just what you do know? I said, you know, it just seems to be, you know, a little game. I said, wag the dog. So he says, oh, really? I says, well, where are you from? So I have to clock this dude. He says, well, I'm from Israel. Oh, okay, you're from Israel. So I said, oh, okay. He says, what do you think? What do you think? He's following me out the damn store. So I said, well, you know, it's all right. It seems to be a big game to me. I don't know, it seems to be something. He said, you know something? And I was walking away, and he said, you're right. We walk back in the store. So I'm saying, okay, now they're clocking me with, you know, with elves. So now I'm picking up now that whoever it is that is on the frequency is, I don't care who you are no more. White people who are saying this is bullshit, that's going to start clocking them. Because we knew it was bullshit, because like I said, as the motherfucking towers was coming down, the niggas was up the block still playing dominoes. They didn't give a shit. I was watching, old people was looking up and seeing it, and then they was playing their dominoes. Ain't nobody dropping a plane in the ghetto. They even went and dropped it over there when them white rich motherfuckers were. The ghetto is safe. People calling me up, Brother Valentine, what are we gonna do? Do we pack? And I said, sit your ass down. Just look at the TV, check it out. You know, tape it. We are all right. The only problem with it is they got these Cointelpro niggas filtering in amongst us. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they watching us to see whether or not we ain't no threat no more, brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters ain't a threat because, have you heard anything in Africa yet? You ain't hear shit about Africa, you hear about North Africa, where Israel is concerned. and wherever the Arabs are at, but you ain't hearing shit about black folks. There's some shit going on with black folks. There is a purging, there is a extermination process going on right now in Africa. That is one of the most horrendous things you're going to want to see, and Africans are participating in it. Now, we ain't getting the news, but what we're about to uncover about who it is that's behind all this shit, you're going to say, well, damn, I knew it all along. God damn. But you know what? It's also got me questioning myself as a Moor. And I begin to understand now what it is that's causing the problems that Moors are facing around the country. We got Brother Moore down in Jersey incarcerated at this particular time. Something is going on and we don't have that other degree. But guess what? It usually comes from the most unlikely places if you look for it. Back in 2000, I was privy to a specific interview with what turned out to be one of the lowest racist motherfuckers out here. But he had information up the yin-yang about who is behind the shit. I'm talking about stuff. It's like we're looking off in the direction right there and somebody's sticking me in the ass and I'm looking up here. It's got to be coming from there. Your ass is back here, motherfucker. Turn around. So I knew it because, see, I was part of the culture. And I think one or two of you all might have been as well. How many people here was a Roman Catholic? Raised a Roman Catholic. Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, hold on to that. See, a lot of the people who don't know anything about the Roman Catholic won't have a clue as to what I'll be talking about and what it is that the true demon, has been doing to you all along. So you had to be raised one to understand what the mentality is. And you'll know the difference between you being a Baptist and Presbyterian versus being a Roman Catholic. And all of that is going to make some sense in a little while. You all got time?
You got time.
All right. Anybody ever saw this?
Yes.
What was it? A special report. What is it called? Look who the Taliban women are. White women. Why were they so hell-bent on freeing the Taliban women? Because the Taliban women have green eyes and blonde hair. Oh! I didn't hear shit about the problems going on in Africa proper with my melanated sisters. But let it be, green-eyed, Caucasian-looking women, and they make the cover of Time. Check the other shot. Don't you just want to maybe just get down and build an altar to this face? What are you looking at? No, archetype religions. Mary. Why do you think they took a picture like this? You think that's an accident? It's not an accident. Wait till you find out who is behind the press that's being pushed on you so that you would be angry enough to send your young boys to die so that you could free these women from the shackles of slavery. Look at some of the shit that they're pushing on you. What does it say at the top? Now, could you imagine us going over here to Brooklyn and snatching up some of these Hasidic Jews and start cuffing off their colors and their bed? Yet still, you're supposed to feel good about the fact that this motherfucker is going to go ahead and what? Tomorrow, I'm going to be shaving off my own beard. But here's the other insult that most people are not looking at. Look at this. You want to know what the Taliban were trying to fight? Huh? Do you think they would allow some shit like that with their women? But they can do that shit to you? They do it to the women here all the time. You crying about Taliban women being enslaved, but the highest incidence of depression, which is at its chronic state, is here in the United States, and it is suffered by women. The highest suicide rate now rising is being suffered by women. There is an ongoing situation with the feminists. Feminists are saying, we got to free these women up. These women don't deserve that. We got to go into Africa and stop them from doing the mutilations. Mutilations, huh? They've been doing it 10,000 years. Anybody ask them why they were doing it? Oh, the men forced them. Men don't do it. Women don't cut off the prepuce of the men, and the men don't cut off the clitoris of the women. Something happened, and nobody's investigating as to why our African genius peoples at the time started that ritual. But guess what? We say in our educated European finest universities that this is mutilation. Yet still they're going over there pushing against that, and the white women over here are performing something called prophylactic mastectomy. What's that? What kind of breasts?
Good.
Healthy breasts! You got these crazy ass white women, at least 10,000 a year, cutting off good breasts. Why? Because the doctor told them you had an incidence of cancer in your line, and in order to protect yourself, that is one of the options. Now wait a minute. You got white women in New York going up to have appointments to cut off their tits. And they now probably gonna stand on a picket line to be pissed off at your culture because you do something you've been doing longer than them motherfucking knuckle draggers have been standing upright. This is not a war to free women, a war to end terrorism. This is a war to crush a specific level of consciousness.
Right.
And they're using the worst examples of those people to get you to use your blanket approval to wipe out any and everything. Remember, he said this war is going on and on and on, and we don't know where we're going to find terrorism. We're just going to go looking for it.
He's gonna find something
too. Oh, you look something long enough, you're gonna find it.
Right.
So now you see in the Time magazine, after 5 years of the most stifling repression, Afghan women are now delighting in life's little liberations. Now I see the sunlight. Unveiled women sing and dance in Kabul. We can see the sun. Most women are still waiting and wearing their veils. Why? Do you know why the women wore their veils? Did you? Were anybody here at my thing when I told you about reasons for the archetypal use of the veil?
Well.
Why? Why did your asses? Wearing the veil ain't had shit to do with Islam. Let me say that again to the sisters. Wearing a veil had nothing to do with Islam. Is an AD religion. You were wearing veils BC, before the confusion. The veil was to maintain your feminine integrity, especially when you walked amongst males. When you walk amongst males, beautiful as you are, you may stir up shit in us. When you stir shit up in us, what happens? We kick off pheromones. We kick off pheromones. Your sensitive anatomy could, by just even smelling another man's pheromones, you could start ovulating amongst a whole troop of men. That's why the women stayed away from the men. That's why married women, based upon their own physiologies being mixed with their husbands, could not be in the presence of too many men. Only the older women after the time of their abilities to have children. This was not repression. This was instinct. This was higher instinct of the women. But the women start acting like these crazy white women, these knuckle draggers, who were having their menstrual cycles every day of month, which was not what your ancestors did. Go check the records. You had your menstrual cycle, if you did, maybe once, twice, most three times a year. Now you're bleeding like a white woman. But of course, I'm wrong, because that must be a chauvinist argument. You know, I've read that men are afraid of women. It's power when they're bleeding. Power? How many women can honestly, I want my Timberlands. You know, I want my Jordans. You don't know what you want, because they tell you what you want. The wounded wound, that's right. My book hopefully will be ready by March, Women's Month. It's called The Wounded Wound. The Wounded Wound. And look at this. They couldn't wait. I bet you they went all over Afghan to see if they could find somebody shaving off their beard. Paid them, probably, yeah. Gave them some money to shave the shit off. In Afghan in central Kabul, Afghan shaves off his beard for the first time in 5 years. Aren't you feeling happy from him?
Not really.
Here's the other part of it. Are you ready for this shit?
Yeah.
Check how it keeps coming. Oh, don't you just feel good for these white women now? We have saved white, pristine, pure, feminine pulchritude. Delivered from evil. Two, how two American women escaped the Taliban. Delivered from evil. These wenches was up there trying to change the women into Christianity. That's what their asses was in jail for teaching the women Christianity and trying to get them to what? Convert. Yeah, true. They should have done a Waco on it.
The thing is, they said the Taliban treated them like they were their little sisters.
Yeah. Yeah. As a matter of fact, they treated them so good that the women in there didn't know what the whole argument was about. Thank you. Forgot that point. Women said, "We rescue? Rescue from what?" Ladies and gentlemen, at this point I'm going to take a break. But after we come back, I got something for Brother Hakeem too. After we do this, it's gonna make him feel good, because it made me feel good. It just blew the whole shit off the lid that the man who I'm taking some of this information from, he left shit out, but he made a mistake and put just enough in to let you know where he got all this shit from. All right? The other part of it is, those of you who had the clay that they liked last time, and they were asking me to bring it, I brought it. With that,
give him a round of applause. Check out the vendors in the back. Brother Sylvia, Sister Sylvia over there, Brother Seiku, Brother Leon, Brother Yusuf.
Hey, man, that's Good girl. Here, have this. This is my son. I mean, what?
Yeah. I am producing him in a minute.
Dave, Doug. Right. So, okay.
Thank you very much. So I reiterate, how many people want to see me that way? Okay, one sister. Any other sisters want to join? Reason why I'm saying that is because you know the kind of teacher I am. Everybody comes here to get their dose of masochistic handing out. I am not one of your motley coddling teachers. I teach with fire and brimstone. So if you hear me talking certain circumstances, probably if you've been here before, you know that I have all my love for my sisters. It's nonsense if you believe that I hate or dislike or have problems with my sisters. I want that to be very clear. And I want to make sure you understand that what I said in the last section, I would like to be very clear at this very point and make sure that you know I meant every damn word that I said. So I just wanted to let you know that, you know, all my love goes out for my sisters. And if any of the sisters who disagree with what I'm saying after the investigations I've done, and if you've done investigations and you feel that we can debate on the situation, like, you know, I guess advanced sentient entities, then I'm all open for it. You know, I've always asked for an open floor or at least somebody to go tete-a-tete with me. I don't run from anything or anyone. So if I can learn, you know I'm ready. But anyway, I want to preface part two by saying that we are in an extremely perilous time. And as brother was saying, especially for brothers like myself and sisters like myself, but more especially for people like yourselves, because now you all are thinking on a whole other paradigm frequency. And your very presence make people look at you differently. And it is those slight differences that is going to either have you survive, or if you misuse your own energy and your powers, could cause you to meet your demise. Each one of us have already clocked the time that we're going to punch out. So there's no sense fearing death. Death is the biggest illusion. Just like what you participate in that you call life, everything is us playing back and forth these roles. So if you're going to choose to take on eyes, ears, nose, a throat, a voice box, a vagina or a penis, a temple that walks around in the sentient, make sure you're doing something with it. Like Reverend Al said when I went to Dr. John Henry Clark's going home ceremony, he said, the hardest thing for a minister to do is to talk at the funeral of a no-account Negro. Because if he ain't did shit, what you gonna say about it? Most of the times you're gonna have to lie. So what I'm asking you all is that, as my brother said, it was perilous, yeah, but once you get to a point where you know what you're doing is correct, there's a conviction that automatically makes you know that you're already protected because you've been assigned, you've taken on the task, and you're gonna move forward with it. So I have no fear, though I am not going to be stupid with it and go out there beating my chest and, you know, stand on top of the Empire State Building and wait for some planes to take me out. I'm not playing Kong here because that ain't me. What I am going to do is to use the word and my presence to try to effect a change. And that's what I want each one of my brothers and sisters here today to be about. If you're not coming here for us to sit together so that we can reason and build so that you can make a difference, then what we're doing essentially is just jerking off with one another. And this is not what I'm about. This is going to be very difficult for us to kind of process, because with the amount of information
that there is no way I can encapsulate it within the short time I have. So everything I have done is to nutshell what I did have so that you could get a quick sample of what you have to do now to dig out the rest of the information. This is what this is about. It's about opening up avenues and doors just enough for you to get your foot in and then kick it in the rest of the way. That's all it's about. So with that, I'm going to begin a journey that's maybe not going to be, you know, as fascinating to some, or maybe not, is not going to be as, you know, oh my God, there's no fireworks involved. But you see, we have been quietly being mind-fucked and killed off and destroyed. And we've been looking for an enemy based upon what was given to us as the enemy. And because we've been given this enemy, we were told, fight that! But sometimes now you got to step back off of your leadership and find out who is leading you. What is the agenda of the individual personally? What is his or her history? Where has he told you to go? Where has she shown you to go? Stop for a moment and to begin to look and to take stock of what you have to invest in order to get something out of it. So, from this point on, I'm going to be reading and every now and then going back to the thing for reference. Okay? The last time you remember, I began to a point that we ran out of time in the other place. And I wanted to begin with how it is we became caught up in this game. And I spoke about we are living under what the Bible calls mammon, as written in the subject index. Mammon is identified or defined as civil law and procedure. Now, you can find this in what is called the Shittah's effect on English law. A law of the Jews becomes the law of the land, found in, mark the word, Georgetown Law Journal. We will find out just what Georgetown is. Volume 71, pages 1179 to 1200. Quote, it is clearly stated in the Law Review that the Jews are the property of the Norman and Anglo-Saxon kings. It also explains that the Talmud is the law of the land. It explains how the Babylonian Talmud became the law of the land, which is now known as the Uniform Commercial Code. They have taken the scripts of the Talmud and they have forged them so that now what was religious pretexts have become, in your definition, positive law. But they're not positive law. The only way that they can institute a belief structure upon you is for you, because along those belief structures, you can assail them if it's a belief structure. They had to curve the belief structure into statutes that look like laws. So now you are taking what essentially is the cultural rendition of a people and have made laws that govern the total of your life. By them. The written credit agreement. The Jewish Shittah is a lien on all property, what they call realty. And today it's called the mortgage. The treatise also explains that the Jews are what? Owned by Great Britain, and the Jews are in charge of the banking system. Well, that's neither here nor there. And we're going to find out about that one as well. It says here at the bottom,
Because you're not a party to the contract, contract being the Constitution of the United States, because you are not a party of the contract, you cannot sue a government official for not adhering to a contract that you are not a party to. So, when you do ask for your constitutional rights, you are essentially in contempt of court. You further indemnify the fact or adhere yourself to the fact that you are not part of the contract by taking out contracts that state undercover that you give up any rights to, even being a participant in the contract. So if you have social security numbers, if you have different licenses, different types of adhesion contracts that you don't know that you even have, your ignorance keeps you a ward of the court, which makes them just dispense summary judgments all over you because you don't know who the hell you are. And because you don't know who you are in your proper entity as a form of God, as God, then they can do anything you want with your ignorant carcass. And that's what they essentially do. Now, you better accept the fact that you are a slave. When you try to use the Constitution, you are committing a crime known as criminal trespass. Why? Because you are attempting to impinge upon a private contract that you are not a party to. Then, to make matters worse, you are a debt slave who owns no property and has no rights. You are a mere user of the master's property. Here are just a couple of examples. The primary control and custody of an infant is with the government. Tillman versus Roberts. Did you hear what I just said? The primary control and custody of an infant is with the government. Go to the site, Tillman v. Roberts, 108 South 62. Listen to this one. Marriage is a civil contract to which there are three parties, the husband, the wife, and?
State.
Oh, did you know that the state was in there rocking with y'all? Yes. And that's Van Coten versus Van Coten. The ultimate ownership of all property is in the state individual. So-called ownership is only by virtue of government, i.e. law amounting to mere user. The use must be in accordance with law and subordinate to the necessity of the state. Do you know we fought this shit for 6 years and kicked their ass with it? I had my home for a while. But you couldn't go in with the procedures that a lawyer would give you because they kick your ass. A lawyer don't come in there to help you. He comes in there to preserve the shit that the court is going to do so he can get his piece. You own no property because you're a slave. Really, you are worse off than a slave because you are also a debtor. The right of traffic or of the transmission of property as an absolute inalienable right is one which has, what?
Never
existed since governments were instituted. So I don't give a who you are. If you say that you are not part of the government state, then you're part of a king or a sovereignty. And even the word sovereignty means that if you're a king in your own proper person, unless you can actually claim the land and defend it, it still ain't yours. It's one that never existed and never can exist under government. Great Britain to this day collects taxes from American people. The IRS is not an agency of the United States government. All taxpayers have an individual master file, which is in code. By using IRS publication 6209, which is over 400 pages, there is a blocking series which shows the taxpayer the type of tax that is being paid. We get a little loan lesson. No, it's fantastic. I appreciate it. Next page. I told you that as of 1996, or was it 97, that Queen Elizabeth has signed the papers as the one who controls your Social Security. Okay? She runs the Social Security in this country. Or she is given the task of managing it. You own nothing. that your labor has never produced. That is what this is about. You own nothing that your labor has never produced. Federal Reserve notes, firms, nothing went into making these pieces of paper because they're worth nothing. They are promises to pay only. So you cannot, what is that, not relinquish the debt.
Discharge
the debt. Good word. Your labor is measured in current debt credit money. You are allowed to retain a small portion of your labor so that you can have food, clothing, shelter, and most of all, what? Need more slaves. Did you ever notice how many of the other slaves get upset if you try to retain your labor? You are called an extremist, terrorist, and sometimes even a free man. I told you to go back to Dune. And what were the name of the people who lived on Arrakis?
Fremen.
The Fremen. And what is that word? Stretched out. Freemen. That is the word Arrakis in there. And again, I want you to look at the date and the numbers and the date that they said this occurred in that part of the universe. All right. When the truth of the matter is, but when the truth of the matter is that you just don't want to be a slave, but you don't have the right to force others to be free if they don't, if they want to be a slave, that is entirely up to them. If they want to bow down and worship corporations, let them. The United States, Great Britain, and the Pope, listen carefully, people, and the Pope are not the problem. It is who? The other goddamn slaves. How many times have we heard that? Living right amongst us. We would be free if the wannabe slaves were gone. The United States, Great Britain, and the Pope would never even exist because no one would acknowledge them. I, for a matter of fact, think that those who are in power are also tired of the slaves. Think about it. Because there's some boring ass, you know? All the slaves do is stand around and moo like cattle. For free health care, free education, free housing, they beg those in power to disarm them. Please take my guns. I do agree that a slave should not have access to a firearm. Only a person who knows that he or she is free should have a gun. A slave should not have a gun. Why not?
You don't know what
you
do with
it. No?
Shoot the wrong person.
You shoot your ass! How can you disagree with the government passing out birth control? I hope the breeding of slaves stops or at least very soon slows down. I see we are cows. The IRS is company who milks the cows, and the United States Inc. is the veterinarian who takes care of the herd, and Great Britain is the owner of the farm in fee simple. The farm is held in allodium by the who? And now, ladies and germs, let us work our way into where it is that we have been overlooking in this equation for the longest period of time. I have not heard anybody, including all of the black, I'm talking about power structuring, ass-kicking organizations, have not yet come to task with this piece of information. Convinced that the principles of religion contribute most powerfully to keep what nations in a state of what?
Passive.
Which they owe to their princes, the high contracting parties declare it to be their intention to sustain in their respective states those measures which the clergy may adopt with the aim of ameliorating their interests so intimately connected with the preservation of the authority of the princes, and the contracting powers join in offering their thanks
to the Pope
for what he has already done for them, and soliciting his consent, cooperation in their views of submitting the nations, Article 3, Treaty of Verona, which we're going to get into. Treaty of Verona, did you say? Oh, Treaty of Verona. Now, wait a minute. Why don't we just do this? Since you all are in your rapt attention, and we have the last of the last information, they mentioned the Treaty of Verona. So why don't we go to the Treaty of Verona? 64th Congress, take your notes. First session, volume 53, part 7, page 6781, 25th April, 1916. I wish to put into the record the secret Treaty of Verona, November 22nd. When did they kill Kennedy? History. Listen carefully. Secret Treaty of Verona, showing what this ancient conflict, listen, what this ancient conflict is between the rule of the few and the rule of the many. I wish to call the attention of the Senate to this treaty because it is the threat of this treaty which was the basis of the Monroe Doctrine. It throws a powerful white light upon the conflict between monarchical government and government by the people. The Holy Alliance, under the influence of Metternich, the Premier of Austria, in 1822, issued this remarkable secret document. Now you gotta remember, who controls the planet? How many people thought it was Rothschild? How many people thought it was Rockefeller? Good. I'm talking to the choir. American Diplomatic Code, 1778 to 1884, Volume 2, Elliot Page, 179, The Secret Treaty of Verona. Now this is where the papacy put down the protocols for how the people are to be treated by the aristocracy, especially those people in the aristocracy who are in the Church of Rome. This is the Church of Rome speaking. The undersigned specially authorized to make some additions to the Treaty of the Holy Alliance, after having exchanged their respective credentials, have agreed as follows. Article 1. The high contracting powers being convinced that the system of representative government is arguably as incompatible with the monarchical principles as the maxim of the sovereignty of the people with the high divine right, engage mutually in the most solemn manner to use all their efforts to put an end to the system of representative governments in whatever country it may exist in Europe, and to prevent its being introduced in those countries where it is not yet known. The church was given an edict. Wherever men and women were to feel freedom, wanted to be free, you make sure it didn't happen. Any governments, any leaders that you may find that is thinking for themselves and wants to have autonomy, you make sure you get an agent in there. And wait till you find out who the agents have been. Now, part two. As it cannot be doubted that the liberty of the press is the most powerful means used by the pretended supporters of the rights of nations to the detriment of those princes, the high contracted parties or patries promise reciprocally to adopt all proper measures to suppress it, not only in their own states, but also in the rest of Europe. It gets better. that the principles of religion contribute to the powerful. Now check it. Didn't we just read that? Most powerfully, to keep the nations in the state of passive obedience, which they owe to their princes, the high contracted parties declare it to be their intention to sustain in their respective states those measures which the clergy may adopt with the aim of ameliorating their own interests so intimately connected with the preservation of the authority of the princes and contracting powers join in offering their thanks to the Pope for what he has already done for them and solicit his constant cooperation in their views of what? Submitting the nations. Now, this is very important not only because it is all related as everything you see 9/11 backwards, but from 9/11 onwards, everything is going to start falling into place. And the next parties, the next shit that's going to hit this country is all-out invasion. All right, we're going to lead up to that. All right? Article 4. The situation of Spain and Portugal unite happily, unhappily all the circumstances to which this treaty has particular reference. The high contracting parties, in confiding to France the care of putting an end to them, engaged to assist her in a manner which may the least compromise them with their own people and the people of France by means of a subsidy on the part of the two empires of 20 million of francs every year from the date of the signature of this treaty to the end of the war. What they are saying is that if we do have agents and people in complicity with what the princes desire, we have allocated a certain amount to pay them every year in order to institute this edict. Article 5. In order to establish in the peninsula the order of things which existed before the revolution of Cadiz, and to ensure the entire execution of the articles of the present treaty, the high contracting parties give to each other the reciprocal assurance that as long as their views are not fulfilled, rejecting all other ideas of utility or other measure to be taken, they will address themselves with the shortest possible delay to all the authorities existing in their states and to all their agents in foreign countries with the view to establish connections tending toward the accomplishment of the objectives proposed by this treaty. This treaty shall be renewed with such changes as new circumstances may give occasion for, either at a new Congress or at the court of one of the contracting parties, as soon as the war with Spain shall be terminated. The present treaty shall be ratified and ratifications exchanged at Paris within the space of 6 months. Now, that Treaty of Verona, as well as the Council of Trent, are the two most damning pieces. The Council of Trent was 25 different sessions. 25 different sessions that took place at the Council of Trent. And at the Council of Trent, that's where the protocols for the establishment of the new Dark Age, the new Age of Inquisition, 2000, began. Okay? You following me? You keeping with me? Okay, just hang on for a minute. Now, what I wanted to do was to catch up with where we were around the Pope and just get back to this. Hence, in jus or jus national, or what is called federal law, the way that they use in Latin, jus national, is how they declare federal. They give you federal law when they write to themselves, that's the word they use. Or the exceptional ecclesiastical laws prevalent in the United States may be abolished at any time by the sovereign pontiff. You hear what they just said? All ecclesiastical laws or any laws prevalent in the United States may be abolished at any time by the sovereign pontiff. That means all laws. Elements of Ecclesiastical Law, Volume 1, 53 and 54. So, could this be shown that the Pope rules the world? The Pope is the ultimate owner of the whole world. See the Treaty of 1213, Papal Bull of 1455 and 1492. Well, I'm glad that you said that. Because I went and got it. Papal bull. What was the papal bull called? Here's a nutshell of the papal bull. The papal bull, in their Latin terminology, is called the inter patera. Now, I got this from the brothers and sisters at the Taino. Taino brothers and sisters who are who? Puerto Ricanos. Anybody Puerto Ricanos here? Say it loud. I'm Taino and proud, right? All right. Here it is up here. Taino form, 99. Check the intercatera. Intercatera, May 13, 1493. 1 year after who?
Columbus.
Uh-huh. What did he bring back for the Pope?
Tainas.
He brought back a Moor in chains. And Pope said, oh, shit, no kidding. All right? Intercatera, among other works well-pleasing to the divine majesty and cherished of our heart, this assuredly ranks highest. That in our times, especially the Catholic faith and the Christian religion be exalted and everywhere increased and spread. That the health of souls be cared for and that barbarous nations be overthrown and brought to the faith itself. Our beloved son Cristobal Colombo, sailing toward the Indians, discovered certain very remote islands and even mainlands. We, by the authority of all who?
Almighty God.
What the fuck is you? By the authority of Almighty God? Listen to these sick motherfuckers you're dealing with now, today. Do give grant and assign forever. What does he say? Forever. To you and your heirs and successors, kings of Castile and Leon, all and the single aforesaid countries and islands. He gave them you. Right? But see, here's where it starts getting deep. Because what is sovereignty now? Let's start questioning what sovereignty is. First, let's go up to Romanus Pontifica, Pontifex, January 8th, 1455. Before that, we bestow suitable favors and special graces on those Catholic kings and princes, athletes and intrepid champions of the Christian faith. To what?
In
vain. In vain. Search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all Saracens and pagans whatsoever and other enemies of Christ wheresoever placed, and to reduce their persons to what?
Perpetual
slavery, and to apply to the appropriate possessions and goods, and to convert them to their what?
Use
and profit. Now, what law reversed that? This is what I was questioning myself as a Moor. I have not yet seen the law that told the Pope to fuck off. Because the Pope put this in place to fuck over the Moors.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you think these are?
The Moors.
Oh, it's going to get deeper. It's going to get deeper. Because the information came from a fucking racist. Not a racist more than we say black folks. But one who takes credit for every fucking thing. Which we know is bullshit. Because they have not yet repeated or created or recreated anything that they say they did. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the intercatera that was actually put together by and instituted by this man. And I'm going to show you who he was on television with a whole new jaundiced eye. Because when I reveal the players, and you see what this deal truly is, it's going to look like you are hopelessly trapped in a circle of people that is not going to relinquish because they have been given manifest destiny. So all laws before them, no matter what it is that you, by your sovereign right, believe, and you, by who you are in your God-given bodies, no matter what it is that your culture has said, that is subordinate because you are not of the Roman faith. You have not submitted to the Pope's infallibility. You do not believe that the taking of the literal Christ body is being given to you when you put it on your tongue in that wafer. You do not believe in what is known as the, what is it called? Not the transubstantiation, it's called. You do not believe in transubstantiation. If you have any contacts outside of this particular faith, you are not, they don't care. If they kill you, you are a hero. You are a hero. Now, Pope Alexander VI, and you got the book, Sources Relating to the History of Law of Nations, Volumes 1 to 4, William D. Guyter, 1989, Volume 2, The Relevant Part of the Bull, Dividing Undiscovered Lands Between the Japanese Portuguese, produced Ibid, page 108, 6 to 108, as quoted. And in order that you may enter upon this great undertaking, so great an undertaking, with the greater readiness and heartiness endowed for the benefit of our apostolic favor, we, of our own accord, not at your insistence nor the request of anyone else in your regard, but of our own sole largesse and certain knowledge, and out of the fullness of our apostolic power, by the authority of mighty God conferred upon us in the blessed Peter, and of the vicarship of Jesus Christ. The vicarship is who Jesus Christ left in charge when he supposedly cut out, which is the Pope, which we hold on earth, due by tenor of these presents. Should any of said islands have been found by your envoys and captains, give, grant, and assign to you and your heirs and successors, kings of Castile and Leon, forever, together with all their dominions, cities, camps, places and villages, and all rights, jurisdictions, and appurtenances, all islands and mainlands found and to be found, discovered and to be discovered towards the west and the south by drawing and establishing a line from the Arctic Pole, namely the north, and the Antarctic Pole, namely the south, no matter whether the said mainlands and islands are found and to be found in the direction of India and towards any other quarter, the said line to be distant 100 leagues towards the west, south from the island, commonly known as the Azores and Cape Verde, with the proviso, however, that none of the islands in the mainlands found and to be found, discovered and to be discovered beyond that said line towards the west and the south, be in the actual possession of any Christian king or prince up to the birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ, just past from which the present year 1493 begins. And we make, appoint, and depute you and your said heirs and successors, lords, lords, of them, with full and free power, authority, and jurisdiction of every kind, with this proviso, however, that by this our gift, grant, and assign, no right acquired by any Christian prince, who may be in actual possession of said islands and mainlands prior to the said birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ, is hereby to be understood to be withdrawn or taken away. In other words, whoever owned the ship before, you can have it. Right? Let me just put these down, because these are historical reference points. Just give you some information so that you could maybe freeze in on it for a little while, so the people at home could probably just freeze their tape and just read it. This is the beginning part of it. That other one was part of the, what do you call it? Here it says, we, through this insufficient merit, have been called to this holy see of Peter, recognizing that as true Catholic kings and princes, such as we have known you always to be, and as your illustrious deeds already known to almost the whole world declare, you are not only eagerly desire, you not only desire, but with every effort, zeal, and diligence, without regard of hardship, expenses, dangers, with the shedding even of blood, are laboring to that end. In other words, you're doing everything for the Catholic faith. Okay? Now, you are laboring to that end, recognizing also that you are, have long since dedicated to this purpose the whole soul of your endeavors, as witnessed in these times with so much glory to the divine name in your recovery of the kingdom of Grenada from the yoke of the Saracens. What does that mean, Moors?
From the yoke of the Moors.
Huh? Recovery? As if they own the shit? Come on, water. Huh? We therefore are rightly led and hold it as our duty to grant you even of our own accord and in favor of these things whereby with effort each day more hearty enable, you know, he's all blah blah. They just love to listen to themselves talk. Let me just put the rest of it down here for you. Oh. Where do we get to the present, we have to lay a foundation for why it is you cannot see the brighter tomorrow. And you won't see it. And why that is. It's funny how you say, well, damn, Brother Valentine, but we come here to find hope. Nah, not today. Not today. There are things that we have to become knowledgeable of first, so that we can have a real understanding of how to navigate. Is not a Moor a navigator? So if a Moor is a navigator, what kind of compass you gonna give him? A broken compass? Run with wrong numbers? You wanna give him a rudderless ship? Now, that is for the purpose of you.
Before I go forward, I have to kind of bring us full circle here so that we could understand where we're heading to. Everybody all right? Are y'all sure now? Don't tell me that y'all, you know, getting bored and y'all want to take a time out? We ain't ready yet. All right? Follow me, please. I'm going to speak to you about a group of people, and I know this is going to be strange because they say, well, Brother Valentine, you only seem to have a couple of pieces of the information. You know, how do you know that the Moors don't have the counter stuff? Well, we, quote unquote, are a defeated people. Until we can man an army, until we can field a general that could take in blood what they took from us in blood. Everything we will do is by treaty. And what is a treaty except an agreement not to be fucked up by the one who just fucked you up anymore? So we could talk about treaties and what it is that we can do inside of the laws, but it's only to a ceiling. We can only walk to a particular ceiling, a specific threshold, and we cannot cross. The only way that we can cross is if we do the rituals that allow us entry, but we have to become them. And thus you are no longer yourself. Take care. Love you, brother. That's my son. All right. So, as things go, and as things have gone so far, until we understand that we are a captive people. I mean, it's like, oh, I'm a black man. Yes, you are. No doubt about it. And it took some 3, 4, 5,000 years to get you. Don't believe they just walked in. This is bullshit. Just don't believe that it all happened overnight. This happened over a process, and guess what? They're using all the shit we taught them on us. And this is why it's so difficult now. Because everything we taught them, they've perverted. And by right of might, do they hold you down? This is not an advanced species. Remember, I told you that any technologically advanced civilization are vicious, unfeeling, and inhuman. I want you to look at this. It says the bad popes, as if there was any good ones. This is a book called The Bad Popes. So you figure you're going from A to Z, huh? Anything written on the popes, I would suggest you get anyway. All right? You should get Unfrocked or Defrocked, another book by the popes, and told you all who all the pedophiles were. But I'm saying this to you, beloved brothers and sisters, because if we do not understand the way that they are thinking as opposed to the way they want us to think, we must get into the mindset of the ones who are the perpetrators. We cannot get the explanation of the guilty or the criminal, because the criminal will always lie. So why should we believe him when he tells us you can do this to navigate in my courtroom? If he was to ever give you the cues to resurrect your people, he'd be suicidal. And he knows he wouldn't do it. So we are given specific tools to travel but so far within specific things, and we maintain our history of ourselves. Every now and then we could dig up gems that they've buried. But it ain't gonna last long, because anyone who has the amount of temerity and ruthless regards of natural law is doomed. It's just that we're living in an interesting time, and we're going to watch a lot of people who've chosen to come and witness and participate in their own deaths. They've written it in their own scripts. So there are those who are elevated and are aware, and we're sitting here together today, reasoning and building together, and there are those who will go down, and if you reach down to try to help them, fuck it, you're going too. There may be some people you're just going to have to leave alone. Trying to explain this to somebody? Where do we start getting deeper? You're going to start, well, you know, it's this and that, and they're yawning on you, and, you know, looking at the watch and shit. Goodbye. You cannot, at this time in your lives, afford to talk with anyone that is not on the frequency. You got to leave them alone. Select those who you wish to reason and build with. And those people who we're talking about, who are the agents and the implementers of this, they are the Jesuits. Get to know the Jesuits. Get to know the Jesuits. Oh, I heard about the Jesuits. Oh yeah, they do all this stuff, and they work in there with poor people and shit. No. From this point on, I'm going to be doing a lot of reading. So I'm going to ask you for your attention and your ear. The Jesuits are the foot soldiers and the military intelligence of the Vatican power structure. A man named Ignatius Loyola began the order in 1536. Pope Pius III gave him the charter. Loyola was a Spanish soldier, very courageous, but during his last battle was severely wounded. He never regained power or the use of his leg, leaving him to become disabled with an exaggerated limp. He had it rebroken several times attempting to fix it, but to no avail. Because of this, the story goes, he convinced himself that no woman would ever seek his favors, and he went into very deep depression. During his solitude, he related that he had a vision, a spiritual vision, whereupon he wrote what he called and what is now known as the Spiritual Exercises of St. Ignatius Loyola. Loyola wanted to start an army. This was his pet project. An army of men whose discipline would be based on his spiritual exercises. His spiritual exercises, therefore, became the basic training for all the Jesuits. One of the Jesuit maxims is, black is white, and white is black. Kevin Costner said this to his people in the movie what? JFK. He He said, hey people, we've got to start thinking like the CIA. Black is white, and white is black. And this was a dead giveaway as to who was responsible for making the movie. So from 1536 on, the Pope has his agents, his provocateurs, and his protectors. And this is when the blood really began to flow. Wars upon wars after wars on top of wars since this time are all attributed to the Jesuits in some way, shape, or fashion. Catholic nobles donated castles, huge riches, schools, and land to the Jesuit order. Everything the Jesuit owns was either given to them or they stole it. Now, the people are led to believe that the Pope is the unrecognized ruler of the planet. But this is a gross misconception. The true ruler is his boss, the Jesuit general. Ladies and gentlemen, meet the ruler of the planet. His name is Count Peter Hans von Kolvenbach. His name is Count Peter von Kolvenbach. Yeah. In his book, The Vatican Assassins, now take down the names of the books I'm going to be telling you. Vatican Assassins, Eric John Phelps has given documented cross-referenced proof that the overseer of the world affairs, the true ruler of the planet, is Count von Kolvenbach. The Jesuit general, like those before him, that is Jean-Baptiste Vincent, Jean-Saëns. Ladies and gentlemen, meet the man who put the hit on John F. Kennedy. He was the Jesuit general before von Kolvenbach. His name is Jean-Baptiste Jean-Saëns, and he was the Black Pope, and that's what they call the true ruler of the planet, the Black Pope. Ain't got nothing to do with color. He's the Shadow Pope. The Jesuit general, like those before him, are in complete control of the entire intelligence community throughout the globe. Now, the reason why I'm going to tell you that, and I'm saying it that way, is because the intelligence community and the people who comprise it are all made up of the Knights of Malta, the Knights Templar, and all of them are Catholics. The creator of the CIA was a Catholic and a Knights Templar. The CIA, the FBI, the Mossad, the KGB, the German secret intelligence corps, the BND, the British SIS, all of them, every bureaucratic agency in this nation is run from the Vatican. The social security system put in place by FDR through the auspices of Queen Elizabeth, who manages it, was put into place here in America with the help in 1933 of Cardinal Hayes. This number that you have, this number system is a Roman ID system. Anybody have a social security card on them? Take it out for a minute. Take it out for a second. Take a look at it. What do you see on it? No, you don't have to look at the numbers. Look at the pictures. The pillars on the side. Those are the Roman pillars, the arches. And that is the Masonic. Joaquin and Boaz, the two pillars of masonry, which is under the control of the Vatican. Welcome to the New World Order. The Knights of Columbus carry out all Jesuits' orders. People like Louis Free, you ever heard of him?
Yes.
Who was he?
CIA.
No. FBI. And he was the FBI head during the Waco massacre. He was a Knight of Columbus. Free's top assassin was a Japanese Roman Catholic named Lon Herucci. So the Knights implement Jesuit orders, all at the time being personally accountable. This man, Louis Free, and all of the hit squads that he has, all of these people in the FBI are personally accountable to the Cardinal. Now, goddamn, look like a kind of sweet old man. You know, he goes up there and he takes interviews and he says mass. Cardinal O'Connell, ever heard of him?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Just as Egan today was considered the king of the American Empire. And he rules his empire from a New York palace called what? St. Patrick's Cathedral. You know what they used to call St. Patrick's Cathedral? You know what they still call it? The Little Vatican. Now, have you ever walked into St. John's the Divine? What other organization on the planet has a church that looks like that? Besides us. And that empire is gone. Have you ever seen the inside of the Vatican? Discover Channel was doing a thing on the Vatican, exposing the Vatican. And they took you on a tour through the Vatican. You need to see it. There is gold everywhere. There is riches, marble. I mean, the opulence. Who the hell, does a regular guy live like that? Have you ever walked into St. Patrick's Cathedral? No, wait, it gets better. The Jesuits are the Gestapo of the Catholic Church. Let me say that again. The Jesuits are the Gestapo of the Catholic Church. It is the Jesuits at Fordham University, the Jesuits at the Fordham University who are sent to keep the Little Vatican in line. The president of Fordham University is CFR member. Now, little history. Anybody ever heard of the Protestant Reformation?
Yes.
Anybody know what the Protestant Reformation was?
Yes.
What was the Protestant Reformation?
When Martin Luther broke away from the Catholic Church.
Calvin, Luther, and all of them broke from what? The Catholic Church. Why did they break from the Catholic Church?
Because they had too much and they had nothing.
Right. In other words, there was the right of kings that was in place. There was a specific type of political leadership in place at that time, and it was based on what? We say we practice democracy. What did they practice? Not only monarchy, it's called something between feudalism. Well, she's gonna go for the gold star at the end of the class. They practice feudalism. Now, Protestant Reformation comes in because what? A few of the people begin to study what the Moors knew. White folks. But they ain't gonna tell you they did. But guess what? Throughout this bastard, this racist's whole diatribe about what it is he was talking about white folks and what it is that the only people that launched a successful attempt against the so-called Catholic Church was the white Protestants, which is why they're going after them here in the constitutional states. But wait till you hear who his forefathers were and what they did. Let me just give you an idea of what the Protestant Reformation was so you can understand what this whole battle is. The history of what appears to be this ongoing state of war and siege began with what is known as the Protestant Reformation, when people around Christendom began to resist the rule of the Roman Church, and they rejected something called the infallibility of the Pope. In other words, the Pope could do no wrong. Said, kill you? Well, kill him. because hey, he's infallible. He represents Peter here, who represents Christ. Rome saw itself being stripped of its power during the Protestant Reformation. Priests were no longer wanted by the people because the people began to read and interpret that Bible for their damn self. Rome was losing good gobs of money. The Christian nations were no longer paying Peter's pence or Roman tribute, what we now call foreign aid. They no longer recognize what is known as the temporal or spiritual powers of the Pope. What were the temporal powers of the Pope? The temporal powers of the Pope meant that whatever he did here in the flesh was correct. Whatever he said and whatever he made or gave as the true and correct thing that we had to do, that was it. It was correct. He is infallible. Therefore, his temporal power over life and death, over decisions and made, all that is real. We can do it. He can do it, anything he wants. Well, the people said, hey, you must be out your mind. You shit, piss, do anything like we do. The Pope no longer had the ability to rule the people through the kings either, because even the kings were no longer listening to him. First king that didn't listen to him was King Henry VIII. Want to know why he is constantly given a bad rep? Because he broke away from the church. And he said, I can have 3 and 4 wives if I want.
Yeah, that's the idea.
You see?
He's still doing it.
Now, Ignatius Loyola was a member of something called the Spanish Alumbrados. Do you know who the Alumbrados were? The Alumbrados were the Illuminati at the time. And this man, Ignatius Loyola, with the establishment of the Jesuit order, he set out with a mandate to reclaim all that the church and the Vatican had lost during the Protestant Reformation. Now, the Council of Trent, that was consisted of a series of 25 sessions. These 25 sessions were staged to systematically condemn all of the doctrines of the Reformation. The council mandate condemns anyone who does not believe in transubstantiation. That is, that the communion host wafer that you put on your tongue is literally and actually the body of Christ, and that the consecrated wine is literally and actually his blood. A, anyone who refuses to believe this is true is accursed. Anyone who believes that their salvation is outside the Catholic Church is accursed. Anyone who believes that the Pope is not the true representative of Christ is accursed. This was the Council of Trent. But, it's the fourth session of the Council of Trent that was perhaps the most vital of all. It was in the fourth session of the Council of Trent that the Jesuits condemned freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of conscience. Let me say that again. At the Council of Trent, the Jesuits condemned freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and freedom of conscience. Hey, are we getting a picture of what is truly going on now in this country? Listen carefully how we're weaving this together. Because now that you see where these mandates are originating, you can now know who the agents are that guise themselves as patriots and Republicans and Democrats and Americans. Because remember, anytime you are in the order, you have no nation. You serve a master. According to the Council of Trent, no man or woman has the right to believe in a higher power that is of his own thoughts. No man can publish what he wants, nor read what he wants. No man may have freedom of conscience. This is put down in the mandates of the Council of Trent. In fact, the first book burning took place at the behest of Constantine when he burned what? The Alexandrian Library. And was he not? Oh, Lord, what time you got?
Ten to nine.
Okay. The first book burning was done by Constantine. The second book burning that is up in history was done in London at the behest of the Pope. in the 1700s and then again in Nazi Germany. Allegedly, it was the suppression by the church that spawned the reformational documents entitled the Constitution. Let me say that again. It was due to the so-called Protestant Reformation that the so-called Constitution was supposedly spurned, when everyone wanted to get together to break away from the infallible power of the Pope. And that would include those who are those whites or Caucasians who went to the Moors to look for help on how to draft shit so that they could put it up to become sovereign from this Pope. Because even the, remember, the Moors themselves were under the fucking guise of the Pope after the defeat of the Moors. All right? Understand. Now, the Presbyterian, listen to this, the Presbyterian Westminster Confession and Faith. Get that down. The Presbyterian Westminster Confession and Faith of 1648, after the 30 Years' War, was an extension of the Calvinist doctrines and was actually set up to resist the power of Rome. In the Westminster document, the Pope is called the Man of Sin, the Roman Antichrist, and denounced the methodologies of Roman Catholics as anti-Christian tyranny. Harry Truman was a Shriner working for the Vatican. He ushered in what was known as the Cold War. What was the Cold War? The Cold War was instigated to enable the Vatican to overthrow the leadership of nation after nation, to replace their legitimately elected leaders with dictators loyal and subordinate to the Pope. It was Truman who signed into law the Emergency Powers Act of 1950, and the Cold War was on in full effect. Countries under martial law, all flags changed in the courtroom and churches. No more laws based on fundamental edicts. All courts functioned with summary procedures only. Juries had no power to nullify juries. Vietnam. One of the big reasons Kennedy was assassinated along with King was that they wanted the war in Vietnam to end. And that war was a CIA war. But Rome began the Vietnam War. Let me say that again. Rome began the Vietnam War. It was affectionately called by those bastards Spelly's War. Who was Spelly?
Cardinal Spellman.
Cardinal Spellman himself went over many times, and he called the soldiers over there soldiers of Christ. The commander-in-chief of the U.S. forces was a CFR Roman Catholic Knight of Columbus named General William Westmoreland. Westmoreland was Spellman's agent, as was another of the up-and-comers at that time, a 33rd degree Mason named Lyndon Baines Johnson. And so was Gay Edgar Hoover. Why was the war started? Because that country, which was Vietnam, southern China, was staunchly Buddhist. And the people there were kind, independent, and, worst of all, inconvertible. They refused to convert to Catholicism. They said, fuck you and your bullshit, Christ, and to Rome. What actually happened was, there had been a Jesuit presence in Vietnam for centuries. Listen to me. A Jesuit presence had been in Vietnam for centuries, but it had proven useless in the conversion process. So it was decided in Rome that at least a million or more Vietnamese people had to be exterminated to purge the area of Buddhism. And so it went. The purge continued with Pol Pot in Cambodia, and they have their eyes set now on Thailand. They purged Laos, Vietnam, and Cambodia. They purged the Buddhists out of China with Mao Zedong. Mao was said to have been funded and controlled, taught by the Jesuits. Rome was also controlling the drug trade that was coming out there. The Vatican controls all drug trade. Heroin, all the opium, all the cocaine. Hey, all of the Colombians are Roman Catholics. From the leaders down to the peasants. Yes or no? In fact, Colombia has a concordant with the Pope. Does anybody know what a concordant is?
Agreement.
An agreement and a treaty. A concordant is a treaty. Hitler had a concordant with the Pope. Mussolini had a concordant with the Pope. Reagan had a concordant with the Pope. And what did he do in that concordant? He recognized Vatican City as what? A sovereign state. That's right.
Okay. Got his own army there?
Mm-hmm. Any country that has a concordat with Rome is controlled by Rome. Let me say that again. Any country that has a concordat with Rome is controlled by Rome. The Jesuit general runs the drug trade. The former general ran it out of China. The Jesuits ran the silk trade. They ran also the pearl trade out of China. The movie Shogun shows you that with the black ships. The CIA was built up from members of the Knights of Malta. One of their founders, one known as Wild Bill Donovan, an Irish Roman Catholic, his brother was a Dominican priest. We getting the picture here? The Jesuits brought in the top Nazi officers into the CIA, since the Jesuits were using the SS to exterminate Jews and all people of non-Catholic faith in Europe. What was the name of the operation that brought in all of the Nazis into the top level of this government? Operation Paperclip. William Casey was a Knight of Malta. Angleton was a Knight of Malta. The Vietnam War was heavily funded because it was a CIA war. It is where they tried out all of their super sophisticated combat technology, their laser weapons, anti-gravity weapons, their invisibility weapons, their cyborg soldiers, was all in Vietnam. Kennedy knew this and he still wanted to resist them. His father warned him, stay out of it. He didn't, he had a conscience. His father, that is, Joe Kennedy, was the most powerful Knight of Malta in the empire. Now, the purpose of the Knights of Columbus was to fulfill Jesuit politics, and part of their job was to restore the temporal power of the Pope. Remember, the Pope lost it in 1870, but he got it back when Mussolini came to power. Now check this. Phelps makes it known in his book that the restoration of the Pope's temporal power around the world is American foreign policy. Let me say that again. The restoration of the Pope's temporal power is American foreign policy. The Council of Trent is the American foreign policy of today. That's what's going on in Serbia, Bosnia. That's what happened when you saw all of that. Do you know why the Bosnians hated the Croats so much? Because the Croats were on the side of the Nazis. And during the time of that occupation, over 800,000 Serbs were exterminated. You want to know why they were wiping those motherfuckers out? The Council of Trent is the American policy. That's what's going on in Serbia. Like I said, the Vatican using the United States Air Force to bomb all people of Orthodox faith outside of Catholicism. Africa is next. Don't you ever think they forgot Somalia. Wherever you see Africans as Muslims or whatever, you can expect mass exterminations to happen. The Jesuits have a secret book of codes, rules, called the Secreta Monita. The Jesuits themselves have an extreme oath of induction. And here is the extreme oath of induction. As recorded in the journals of the 67th Congress, third session of the United States, House Calendar number 2, number 53, recorded in 1913. Anything special about 1913, my brothers and sisters?
The Federal Reserve.
FBI.
This
is what the Jesuits must say when they are either kneeling on a sword or holding the sword by the hand. Let's go on. The Secreta Monita, which I brought here, but I can't put them all on because the Secreta Monita is about this thick. I have the words of the Jesuits and what they must do in order to conquer nations. Now, the Secreta Monita, it instructs them on how to ingratiate themselves with all peoples, especially rich widows. It tells them how to insinuate themselves into governments. In fact, based upon the content of these discovered codes, it is said that the true authors of the Protocols of Zion were in actually the Jesuits. I don't see nobody else but the Roman Catholics in government. Running it at the highest level. I see Jews running around them. Now
you know, I ain't no lover, but we got to look at the reality of things. As an order and organization, the Jesuits were abolished from countries and nations 39 times. Do you imagine? What kind of record is that? To be kicked out of a country or countries around the world 39 times. Elizabeth I expelled them for that. They usurped the throne and put the son of the Mary's Queen of Scots in the throne of England, in place of Elizabeth I's son. The Earl of Southampton, who was known as Worsley, the son of Edward Devereux. Edward Devereux is the man you know as William Shakespeare. There was no Shakespeare. The man called that was head of the Globe Theater and was the Lord High Chamberlain to Queen Elizabeth, who secretly had a son with him, the third Earl of Hampton. It was he who was the rightful heir to the throne of England, not King James VI from Scotland. Read Shakespeare Identified by, it's a book called Shakespeare Identified by Lunay. And also The Star of England by Carlton and Dorothy Ogborne, published in 1952. Know that the madness we are all now witnessing are the result of an ongoing 30 years war. Every 30 years there's a war. The Jesuits are hell-bent on reversing all religious freedom to bring back the time of the Inquisition. In fact, it was Louis XVIII who formally started the Inquisition in England and Ferdinand VII who started the Inquisition in Spain. To know the 30 Years' War is to overstand, and you have to overstand, the second 30 Years' War started in 1914 and ending in 1945. Note, in 1639, the Jesuits were expelled from Japan. And for 200 years, they never forgot. Remember what happened in 1945? The Jesuits assassinated Lincoln. John Wilkes Booth was never killed. He was a knight, and he confessed to it on his deathbed in New Orleans. Popes who do not obey the Jesuits are either humiliated or killed. Read the book, In God's Name, by David Yallop, Y-A-L-L-O-P, where he reveals how Pope Paul I was assassinated after 33 days on the papal throne. Oh, and get this, do you know what is under the papal throne? Do you know what's written under the papal throne? Where Peter's representative sits? Well, under the papal throne it says, there is no God but Allah. And Muhammad is his prophet. It goes back to the time of the Crusades when they were stealing every fucking thing they could put their hands on to bring it back to Rome. Back to the 30 Years' War. Rome controls and has created the Israeli government. It was the High Masonic Rothschild-controlled Zionist Jews that had the alliance with the Jesuit general in 1876. Guess who the general was in 1876? Adam Weishaupt. Who was the general? Who is Adam Weishaupt? Who? Starter of the Illuminati where?
Bavaria.
In Bavaria, a Jesuit stronghold. Get Mark Lane's plausible denial. That'll tell you that story. Who trained the Mossad? Reinhard Gehlen, a knight. Read The Secret War Against the Jews by a man named Loftus, L-O-F-T-U-S. The Knights of Malta run Jerusalem. Remember, for the Jesuits and all Catholics, they want the seat of all power to be in Jerusalem as per the dream of Ignatius Loyola. Now pay attention. To do this, they must destroy something called the Dome of the Rock. Have you ever heard of the Dome of the Rock?
Yes, sir.
All right. The Dome of the Rock is Muslim, and it sits on the chosen temple site that the Knights Templar wish to build on. Look out in the future when the U.S. bombs or destroys the Dome of the Rock, leading to all-out war in the East and in the West. It is said that Cardinal Spellman controlled the Federal Reserve Bank and the Council on Foreign Relations. The Council on Foreign Relations actually belongs to the Vatican. William F. Buckley, who is a member of the CFR, was purported to have helped in the assassination of Kennedy. The Knights control the money, and I know this personally because when I was in court, back and forth, trying to fight these fucking banksters, who were in there trying to keep and take my home when I looked up the opposing attorney, Knights of Malta, right there. Right under his name, Knights of Malta. All right? They control the Bank of Canada, they control the Fed, and they control the Bank of England. All right? As a matter of fact, it was the Jesuits who gave orders to J.P. Morgan to sink the Titanic. Because J.P. Morgan was going to start, the Titanic was going to be competition. He was starting something called the White Star Line. Familiar? What did I just say?
Black Star
Line. Zionism with Theodore Herzl, Ben-Gurion, Golda Meir, all of these bastards were supposedly under the power of the Jesuits. They are the rulers. They are the protocols. Ask yourself, which nations were responsible for creating Israel?
England, U.S., Germany, and France.
Yes. And so Germany, Nazi Germany as well. Mm-hmm. And get this, Phelps, the racist, rats on the Nation of Islam in his book. Check what he says in his book on Vatican assassins. He says Chicago was ruled by Archbishop Cody. Check. The nation was started in Chicago. He said, if nothing goes down in New York without the Archbishop knowing, what makes anyone think that the same doesn't happen in Chicago without that Archbishop's approval? Phelps claims that the FBI and the Nation of Islam are stations for high-level Shrine of Freemasonry. Let me say that again. Phelps claims that the FBI and the Nation of Islam are stations for high-level Shrine of Freemasonry. He states that Masons control both the KKK and the Nation. One agitating blacks, the other agitating whites, all to the glory of the Jesuit orders. He also claims that the true working capital of the United States, or the United Snakes, is Georgetown University. Listen carefully. Georgetown controls all Freemasonry. All right? If you go to Baltimore, Maryland, and I know Freemasons in the house might bear me out on this. If you go to Baltimore Fair, you find a huge lodge directly across from Jesuit University. Do you think that they're enemies? More history. Moscow was once considered the third Rome. First there was Rome, then Constantinople, and then Moscow. That was the next thing. Read the book Descent into Darkness by a man named Zatko, Z-A-T-K-O. Ho Chi Minh had a concordat with Pope John the 23rd, and he was personally under the advice of a Roman Catholic bishop all throughout the Vietnam War. Again, the purpose of the Cold War was to fulfill the mandate of the Council of Trent. Let me get this done for you. The Vatican controls the National Council of Churches and the Royal Council of Churches. They're even gaining control of many Protestant universities. Let me show you something that I found. How many people know about the Jehovah's Witnesses? Let me show you something I found hanging in a goddamn hallway. What does that say, everybody? Oh, is everybody awake? Have the Jehovah's Witness organization changed their teaching about the Holy Trinity? Listen, you want to know what's getting ready to happen? If they got the Jehovah's Witnesses, God damn, you can't move them with blasting caps. They are some dead walking motherfuckers. They're knocking the door. Have you gotten? No, okay. If they can get them to change, listen up. Congratulations to be given to all witness organization for finally deciding to move closer to us changing their long-standing view about the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, teaching that they are one God with three distinct manifestations of himself known as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Glad for you by the way. In the past, followers of the Jehovah's Witness organizations have openly changed their beliefs about Jesus Christ being what? The eternal, not created God, and being co-equal in power with God the Father. But we got all that shit down, and they're telling you where it is in their books. But let's go down here. Since the Jehovah's Witness organization was started over 100 years ago, these teachings were steadfastly, adamantly rejected by the Jehovah's Witnesses organization as heresy and false doctrine.
Because the Jehovah's Witnesses refuse to accept Christ as being Lord, something that is eternal for obtaining salvation and life. What is it? Romans. Millions of Jehovah's Witnesses in America and around the world, what? Have been deceived and misled and have lost out on their hope of gaining everlasting life. With these recent changes in doctrine, the Jehovah's Witnesses organization is now adopting a more classical, classical view of Orthodox Christianity. What's the most classical one you got?
Catholic.
The Catholics. Listen. And now moving closer towards accepting as a legitimate Christian organization. In other words, anyone outside the rubric will be brought in or destroyed. Check it out. What now has the Jehovah's Witnesses believed? Jehovah's Witnesses, listen carefully, have also changed their view about joining the military and about the death penalty, and are now teaching people that it is right to bear arms for the purpose of wars to kill people.
Break it down, brother. Break it down.
Wait a minute now. I can't talk to them the way I used to talk to them now. They might want to go in this slide and pull out their Glocks and defend Jesus. And here they tell you which magazine tells you it's all right to kill people now.
As for George Bush Jr., he is a descendant from the House of Stuart in England. His grandfather Prescott helped to found the CFR. His uncle is a Knight of Malta. He was chosen to be president by the College of Cardinals. Everything and every other candidate was just bred in circuses. Let me name it off to you. Pat Buchanan was Jesuit trained. McCain is a Roman Catholic. The brother Keyes is a damn Roman Catholic. It's all game. Ted Kennedy is a Knight of Columbus, and he keeps advocating what? Vaccinate all, everybody, especially the black people. For that, they made him senator for life. Now, let me sum it all up for you all, brothers and sisters. The purpose of the Jesuit order was to destroy all traces of the Protestant Reformation. Check it. They call it the Counter-Reformation. A man named Niccolini in Rome wrote, quote, "The Jesuits, by their very calling, by the very essence of their institution, are bound to seek, by every means right or wrong, the destruction of Protestantism. This is the condition of their existence, the duty they must fulfill or cease to be Jesuits." This is from a book entitled Footprints of the Jesuits by R.W. Thompson. Thus, the Jesuit order, the Society of Jesus, was henceforth recognized as the chief opposing force to all things that protest. Let me say that again. The Jesuits became the chief opposing force to all who protest. The order became dominant in determining the plans and policies of what is known as the Roish Church. It began in France first, Italy, Spain, and then spread like a fungus throughout all other civilized nations. The Jesuits became the authors of what is known as socialism and communism. You see, the economic system of the Dark Ages, and you can actually plan that back and see that the Jesuits were responsible for that if they have a mandate to reestablish the power of the church. Because back at the time when the church was in its greatest power, it was called the Dark Ages. And during the Dark Ages, Roman Catholics ruled under feudalism, which consisted of a few dealing all the isms on everybody else. Check?
Sure.
All right. A few of the rich over the most of the poor. The church made it a sin. Check this out. There is actually an edict and a bull by the church, which is a sin for anyone but the feudal lords to make a profit. So, If you look at it, we are all returning to the so-called Dark Ages under the corporate feudal lords, which is why the protesting middle class had to be destroyed. Socialism and communism accomplishes this, but so does democracy, which is actually both of them in disguise. The Order of the Illuminati was officially founded in a Jesuit stronghold in Bavaria by a Jesuit general. Of course his name, Adam Weishaupt. And now to the present as we wrap up. The culmination of the second 30 years war and the beginning of the third 30 years war was 9/11. Listen carefully. As a result of the Cold War, Europe, Russia, North Africa, Japan, all of them, America as well, all laid in ruins. All by the Society of Jesus. Millions upon millions of heretics, and now those who are called non-believers were exterminated. Think about it. From the years 1945 or 1913 or 14 as we spoke to 1945, from 1945 to 1990, millions upon millions of people who were not under the rubric of Roman Catholicism were exterminated. Think about that as you begin to quantify the information now, whereas history was this disparate circumstance that you were trying to piece together. Think about the fact that all the wars now were under the leadership and rulership of Rome, the Rome that we don't know anything about. During the Cold War, the good cop, bad cop was played out between the United States and Russia. Remember that one? We are the place of freedom. They have bad communism. Both sides were actually financed by the international banking cartel centered in London and New York, the Fed and Chase Manhattan. The thesis, antithesis. Have you ever heard about thesis, antithesis? Thesis is, we got problems. Antithesis, what are we gonna do about it? So the thesis, antithesis, and the final synthesis, that's what the solution to the thesis and antithesis is. You have thesis, antithesis, synthesis. So the synthesis of all of what you saw happening in the 330 years war is actually for the final destruction of the American empire. Listen carefully. May be true, may not be true, but listen and then put all the information you see around you together. The illusion of the ending of the Cold War would legally enable Rome's corporate monopolies federated together in New York City under the CFR to give Russia and China highly advanced technological equipment and financial banking. What is happening today, people? What happened that they was going to take Bill Clinton out and shoot him? What did he do? No. What is it that he did that was supposed to... Say that again? Yes, he did. What was the deal? Okay, anybody got it? Remember when they supposedly caught a spy? And it was supposed to be selling all these highly advanced secrets to China? But no selling going on. They were giving it to China. What happened over the past 20 years, 10 years, in China that was this big thing that happened? No? Yeah, Tiananmen Square, but what? Now, Falun Gong, which is also outside of it, but that's the Jesuits don't like Falun Gong. But what's that? No. Yes! China was given Hong Kong. Why? Because Hong Kong is a financial behemoth, and that is what China needed to restart its war economy. Listen carefully. It was for this reason that the financial might of Hong Kong was returned to Red China, along with, get this, the American naval base in Long Beach, California, is manned by the Chinese. It was for this reason that the Panama Canal was given back to Panama and is now being manned by, guess who?
Chinese.
The Chinese. Is there a patent building up here? It was for this reason that the Jesuits in control of Washington established nationwide gun registration for the purpose of nationwide gun confiscation, just as was done in Hitler's Nazi Germany. It was for the same reasons that international corporations managed by the Knights of Malta financed and continued to build both Russia and China's war machine, while at the same time ordering presidents to what? Close down scores of military installations in the United States? What's that for? And and the destruction of the Dome of the Rock. Now, in fact, if you're not looking at this, you can see that the fact that they are taking all our troops and sending them over there in this frivolous war. It's not even a war, police action. It's sending our kids off, all the ones that would defend us. And they're importing Russian soldiers. They got them in Pennsylvania. They got Chinese soldiers in Arizona. They got all different kinds of soldiers that don't speak your language and don't give a shit about you. When this happens now, all this has to be leading up to some kind of mass invasion. Right? Now here's the thing I want to drop for the Moors. Check this out. The Knights of Malta already removed most of their money from the European, into Euro dollars, marks, and Swiss francs. That means the American dollar ain't shit no more. The unification of Europe, check this out, is supposed to be actually to restore the power of the Holy Roman Empire. This is why the Jesuits shaped or staged Jubilee 2000 and are rapidly rebuilding Rome. Rome is going under this huge reconstruction. When the smoke clears in a few years after 9/11, we will begin to see the true picture. China will control the East, Russia will control the North, the European nation, as a unified Catholic Europe, will control the West. Note, the Afghan war, watch it very closely. See who gets the major benefit from the Caspian oil line. Watch if it isn't China. In the end, you will see that the Knights of Malta declared Jerusalem as the international city, and one world order will be coming under the Pope. He will then manifest that. But check this out. I want you to see this. I'm going to wrap this up. This man is a racist who says that the most successful fight that was ever staged against the Catholic power of Rome was done by white Anglo-Saxons, Protestants, who has today been able to fight them tooth and nail to this point. Where is the collection of the most Protestants in the world?
The
United States of America. So, now that you've watched the way that all nations begin to fall one after the other, when Hitler left his troops in Russia to be slaughtered, when Russia's troops were left to be slaughtered, what do you think they're doing with the kids over there in Iran, in Afghanistan? Now, this racist said something that was made him put his foot in his mouth. Check this. Read this. The Black Pope now has a perfect war between two peoples he wishes to destroy. For both peoples, the white and black Protestants and Baptists, along with the Jewish race of North America and the Semitic Muslims of the Middle East, are condemned by the Jesuits' evil and wicked Council of Trent. They having been historically the greatest enemies of the Jesuit order, infallible Pope, who since the days of Innocent III in 1215 has claimed to be the one true God on earth. According to Motley's The Dutch Republic, it was Americans, white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, Calvinist, Dutch, Reformed forefathers, known as the Wild Beggars of the Sea, who gave religious liberty to the Bible-based Western civilization. These doggedly fearless sailors, in stoutly resisting papal tyranny, wore an Islamic crescent, not a cross, in their caps. Immemorial inscriptions written below, rather Turkish than Popish. Now where the fuck did they get a crescent and a star from?
The Moors.
You damn skippy. So when he was talking about, you got to read the book. You got to read all this shit about how the great white and you the great white and the great white. But then he goes and then he comes there and tells in the Dutch Republic that these wild beggars of the sea who gave religious Bible-based Western civilization, these godly fearless sailors, the only way a white man comes godly is if he comes in contact with black folks. Because nothing spiritual ever came out of you. Nothing. Nothing.
What book is that?
It's called The Dutch Republic. It's by Motley. Now,
these godly fellow sailors and stop me resisting papal tyranny, war, and Islamic crescent? Why would anybody put on something and go to fight against someone unless that something meant something to them? You don't just put shit, well, that should look good here. You put it here. The reason why they put on the Islamic crescent and not the cross is because they understood that even with the war against religious freedom, even in the times of the Crusade, Roman Catholicism was so brutal, so vicious, so heartless, and so aspiritual that most of the whites from Europe were running to the Saracen kings, please give us shelter. And they were given shelter. And they could practice the way they wanted to. Because under that part of what they call Islam at that time, it wasn't about taking your faith from you.
That's right.
But in the beginning, of course, when you're dealing with white folks, that was okay. But you see, you Negroes, they come in, you're going to be Islam. And what do? They raped our women, took the sons from the rape, and raised them as their own, and had our own sons lording over us to adopt Islam. Because remember, we had the ancient Kemetic understanding, the highest of all understanding, and they took it and they perverted it. But I just wanted the brothers and the Moors to see this so that they can understand this book. This book will hold a lot of secrets to some of the history as to what was going on. Now, in summarizing, I hope I have given you at least some idea, because I haven't even scratched the surface, we have to rush, of the monumental depth of deceit and treachery that we are dealing with here on this continent today. Do not be surprised if we are attacked wholesale from the air, from the land, from the sea, and that the soldiers who are doing it are your own under the tutorship and the leadership of others outside of this country. Now, I ain't saying that to scare you. I'm just saying, you know, keep your powder dry. Keep it hidden, if you have to. But it's going to get deep in this country before it gets any better. Yep. You can bet your ass on that. As a matter of fact, don't bet your ass, because you won't lose. I would suggest that you do put your foods away, do what you have to do, store, be a squirrel, it's a poor rat that only got one hole. You understand? Yes, brother.
Peace. Did you hear about there was an Ebola breakout?
Yes,
sir. On the Afghanistan border,
mm-hmm.
as well as Iran, and I heard that they have 140 quarantine camps now.
Yes.
And what they're thinking is that the Taliban and so on and so forth, and Bin Laden brought from these Russian scientists the Ebola Caribbean virus. And it was one guy who was able to aerosolize it and make it airborne.
Right.
And they figured it must have got airborne to spread it. Now they said that this was part of phase two,
right,
of what they was talking about dealing with the total destruction of America.
Mm-hmm.
And there was an article with all of these ones who studied that,
mm-hmm,
have been getting killed left and right.
Oh yes.
And turned up disappearing.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the ones who possibly come up with the cure for this.
Well, the whole cure, beloved, is the kinds of foods that you're eating that have already a perverse base within them. That predisposes your body to become that. Ebola and that type of virus or that kind of disease is only effective upon malnutritioned bodies. Now, you could be obese and be malnutritioned. Doesn't mean that you're not looking like you, what do you call it? But any diseases that are based upon putrefaction and the proliferation of putrefying or putrefactive habits, that makes you susceptible.
And what was interesting about it was the guy who reported what was happening with these bases, the name of his website was James.com.
Mm-hmm.
The minute the guy who spoke on this issue spoke on it, that same night, not only was the website pulled down,
yes,
but it was erased from all the search engines.
Yes.
Now, not anybody can erase a website from search engines now.
Only carnivore can.
All right.
Only carnivore can. And that's the thing, brother. Thank you. That's Brother Hakeem Bey. Give thanks. What we have essentially today, brothers and sisters, is that all of what we have been teaching to this point, like I said, I can only give you enough of the information so that now that you're looking at circumstances with a different eye, you're looking through a different lens now. When you see the Catholics come on and they make such a big pomp and circumstance about the funeral of this cardinal and why we have to do this and cardinal that and why the presidents all go to see the... That's because he's running it for the Pope. Now, quickly, I'm going to run down the order so that you can understand. You just got a whole new archbishop, didn't you?
Yeah.
Look at this fact. Get a shot of him. What does that say? Archbishop of the capital of the world, whose master is Pope John Paul II. It's interesting how Pope John Paul II came about. This man was a pedophile who was banished to Poland at the time. When he was banished to Poland, he was being tutored and given rest and comfort by the then head of IG Farben for the East. IG Farben was the one that supposedly gave all the gas and nerve toxins for the extermination camps. This Pope was in Poland at the time, and it was interesting that at the time in Poland, that Poland was going through some kind of reform change. And all of a sudden, when he became Pope, Poland started going through hell at the time. Remember? Right after he became Pope, all the hell began to break loose in Poland. Why was that? Well, you see who the little Pillsbury doughboy, his boss, Pope John Paul, the governor of the world. And what does it say there?
Master.
Whose master is? Let me just put it up here for you to see.
Thank you.
All right?
Yes, sir.
So, this is the man here who right now allegedly controls everything that is done on this planet. And at this time, he has cut a deal with the Red Chinese government. And that's why you see Falun Dafa. That's why you see the persecution of Tibet and the Tibetan people. Why? Because the Tibetan people are Buddhists. And they have their own version of the Pope. Who is that? The Dalai Lama. Who is what? What does that mean? The Holy Lamb. Remember, the Dalai Lama has more people, and he's just as popular as the damn Pope. And the Pope is supposed to be the Lamb of God.
I'd like to add on, I'm sitting back and observing the designs that the first one you showed us,
mm-hmm.
we had the Delta going down.
Yes.
We had the designs from France. And
right.
France was Moorish jurisdiction one time.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see the same designs on his garb.
Yes.
And the same designs on the garb before that.
Uh-huh.
With the Pope with the crown symbolic to affairs.
Right.
If you look at the Prophet Noble Ju Ali of 1913, mm-hmm. look at his sash.
Right.
It's the same design.
Uh-huh.
You understand?
And they're wearing it.
Yes, exactly.
They're wearing it. So, you notice my boy with the, he's talking about the fish head.
Right.
And you notice it is the fish.
The age of Pisces.
Denoting Pisces. And it's also supposedly the reptilian, which is actually the crocodile, which is Apep. Uh-huh. which is an ancient, what do you call it? And of course, I don't know how you feel, but I just ain't got, you know, I don't know about dealing with no motherfucker that's got a big stick with a dead man hanging on it.
that shit freaks me the fuck out.
That's right.
You know, I haven't been talking about God, but brother was speaking about
the design
itself, and how all three of them had it.
Right.
See? And of course, the top of the crook that he carries there is not the man, it's also the head of the serpent. You see it? Right. Okay. So, all in all, some creepy motherfuckers, you know? And this is the man now that controls global politics. So, I'm prayerful, brothers and sisters, that in this last time that we are together, that with whatever it is that we've shared over this past year and the past few years, that the information that was shared back and forth here today will carry over as you too become teachers and people building with brothers and sisters in circles like your own. Because like I said, I'm going to only do this kind of political rendering as the time sees fit. Now is the time for me to be speaking to you on the metaphysics of spirituality and how to enhance the true armor, the armor that they're trying to catch the chink in, to cut you off from. And that is your own spirit, your own understanding and understanding of yourself.